the hosts of the Swine Brothers show are not role models. They're not even human. They're complete monsters. The Swine Brothers show is dumb, crude, thoughtless, ugly, sexist, self-destructive, foolish, and a crime against humanity. Some of the things they do would cause a person to get hurt, expelled, arrested, possibly deported. The fact they blatantly ripped this off from another source should be an indicator of their shameless depravity. This extreme and bad taste will offend anyone with a working brain, so listening with discretion is advised. If you're still here, welcome to the sewer of the internet.
The curse of human stupidity is never ending.
Yes, that is a great intro. Welcome to the Swine Brothers Show, episode 183. You can get in contact with us if you'd like to for questions, comments, suggestions, death threats at cosmicgodsdie@gmail.com and Swine Brothers on Facebook. I think it's SwineBros666. And of course, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share.
Yeah.
Especially with your enemies.
Yes, your enemies need to hear this.
I am your usual host, Ellie Lenoud.
I'm Jim the Seeing Eye Mutant, and boy oh boy, have I gotten pissed off over random bullshit.
Just before we get into that, I hope you've enjoyed my little solo videos I've been doing, just to sort of, you know, have some content on this channel. So, what are you pissed off about today?
Oh, the fact that I can never have suffered the things I have suffered.
And why is that?
Because I was born a certain way.
Yes.
And I don't give a shit. Every time I hear you're stupid because you're born a certain way, I remember all the times I fucking debated neo-Nazis. God, I deprogrammed a couple of them. And now you want to undo my work.
Well, this even sounds like a neo... Just the name of it sounds like a neo-Nazi thing.
Yeah, it sounds like something straight out of Dr. Josef Mengele saying, look at me, I'm like the best in racial studies.
Yes, 14 words.
Oh, God. Why does this shit exist? And it all boils down to this stupid dichotomous thought. You're either for us or against us. Gee willikers, Bobby. I remember whenever I used to use that mentality, but that mentality was like, you're going to fucking give me my money or I am going to bash your face in. Now pay up for the drugs you got.
You know, I use that mentality as well. You know what? You know what the difference between me and them was, Jim? I was 14, 15, 16.
You see, I didn't really use that mentality until I started selling drugs, and then I stopped using that mentality whenever I stopped selling drugs. That should tell you, like, how fucking pathetic, you know, this dichotomous bullshit is.
The mentality is... So what we're talking about is critical race theory, which sounds like a 14 words thing, but whatever. And the essential thing is you're either a racist, or no, you're either an anti-racist, you're fighting the system, or even if you're not a racist and you're not, if you're not doing as much as we are, then you're a racist.
Yeah.
Which is, but like, which is again, when I was 14, 15, 16 years old, into the whole anarchist community, I said that anyone who wasn't doing, granted, I was doing nothing, but anyone who wasn't listening to as many Crash records as I was part of the evil capitalist system. And then I go off and get Burger King.
You see, I remember, you know, whenever I fucking raged against capitalism, and all I wanted was, like, this system in place where people could go to work, get paid for their work, spend their money on whatever the fuck they wanted, regardless how stupid or if it fucking, you know, made them more money, like, you know, buying and selling drugs does, and, you know, just, you know, whatever the fuck you want. And then I found out years later, oh yeah, the system I described was capitalism. So I was fighting against the very thing I wanted.
Now, I'm not saying it's perfect, and I live in a state which is far from perfect,
well,
but
fuck,
it's
I grew up whenever the fucking, huge corporate scandals were blowing up. God, Exxon Mobil, that was like, ooh. Oh,
yeah. That was a beauty.
Yeah, and so, like, you know, I knew I hated the corporations and all this shit, and I didn't realize that, yeah, that may be part of capitalism, but there's other parts to it, too, such as I can give $5 to my friend for a cheeseburger. You talk to someone that escaped some fucking socialist country, you give your friend $5 for a cheeseburger, you see how quickly they were put in prison for being a filthy capitalist, because it's the state's job to give the cheeseburger, not yours.
And, of course, you have no actual say about, well, not being on a cheeseburger, but big appliances, you have actually no say in a socialistic of anything. You basically, you order it, and it'll come when it comes. I don't even think you get to choose the color.
No, I loved what you were telling me about the fucking, what's it called? Yugo.
Oh, yes. Well, yes.
Because you have to remember, socialism's all about the environmentally sound and workers' rights.
Most of the workers drank on the job, and I think it was the most polluting car. I think it had to be extensively modified to be imported to the U.S. I think everyone knows what the Yugo was, the imported Yugoslavian car of the 80s.
Yes, and this filthy capitalist actually had ecological standards that, like, you know, we didn't want smog-producing cars.
Yeah, it had to be, I think it had to have fuel injection, because it was based on a 1960s Fiat design, and it was not kept up, because if you have a monopoly on something, there's no need to improve your product, right?
Yeah.
Because people are going to buy it regardless. So it was not, you know, improved upon. And
this all just goes to that dichotomous thinking. It's like, yo, yeah, sure, I would just sit here and say I'm a capitalist now. But, you know, the whole thing is I still don't like corporations. I still avoid as many as possible. I can't tell you the last time I was at Walmart, I was dating a chick who got her prescriptions from Walmart. And so I took her to Walmart to do her shopping and get her prescriptions. And that was over a year ago.
I mean, that's the thing about, you're either with us or with them, is most people don't have the time or patience. To even people who agree with you don't have the time or patience to be full-time activists because they have lives. And so
it's not just that. What if you're doing something to protest that's actually hurting the effort? I mean, you think it's a good and righteous thing to, you know, burn down black-owned businesses. Oops, oh, that you did that. Yeah, we've got that on record.
Yes.
But that's helping the black communities by burning down their mom-and-pop shops.
Which hurts, yeah. Which horribly hurts them. But yeah, if you're not as committed as we are, or if you just disagree with something we say, I mean, that's how bad it's gotten. I remember when it was a different saying. It was just systemic, you know, back then. It wasn't
CRT. It's like, yeah, okay. You try thinking, God, I hate the comeback, too. It's like, you know, so that's rather bold of you saying that racism and sexism doesn't exist. Did you miss that part, like, 5 seconds ago? Like, whenever I said I debated literal neo-Nazis? We're not talking, you know, people on Twitter calling you one. No, I'm talking, like, legit 14 words. They fucking had the tattoos of the fucking... God, I love the tattoo of this one. It was such a beautiful work of art. If it wasn't and if it wasn't for the context of it, I'd say yeah, but the context of it was a Confederate soldier, an SS trooper, an SA trooper, all hoisting the Iron Eagle flag like it was the fucking landing at Iwo Jima. I mean, it was a beautiful work, but like the content of it was like, God, dude, that's how into it he was, and I was debating them, and I fucking deprogrammed that one. That was hard. That was fucking hard. The only thing I did was I married a black chick, and I didn't change. Granted, the black chick ended up being the wrong woman, because, you know, whatever, but You know, that's how relationships work. Doesn't matter what color you are. Fucking relationships fail because sometimes someone's a piece of shit, and sometimes I was a piece of shit, and sometimes
that's how she scary. Was, and
fuck, you know, that's how a relationship works, and, you know, eventually just got to the point where I said, enough, I'm not going back.
That's how scary it gets, though, is that the if you disagree with me, then you're saying that it doesn't exist. I mean, that's how freakish it gets sometimes. And as I was saying, I've had, you know, back when this was just called systemic, you know, racism, whatever, not CRT, I remember people posting about it. And like I said, when I said I maybe didn't agree with everything they said, I was, you must, you know, you're supporting racism, you're a racist, and got, you know, disowned by former friends.
You see, I remember as the boomers shifted from being hippies to being politicians elected into office and they became the establishment, they tried all their fucking quick fix fucking, you know, legislation, and most of it failed. Some of it worked, some of it was common sense, but other shit was like, And so now you got kids raging for the same exact shit which failed before. It's like,
Well, they didn't do their history. Well, then again, we were talking about this last night, is what I don't even know what history's taught anymore. When I was in class, it was fairly straightforward. I mean, yeah, they didn't go into every detail because, you know, they did not enough time, but it's fairly straightforward. I don't know what's happening today.
Oh, yeah. It's like, well, we heard all about the wars that the fucking different Native American or Indian tribes, depending upon, you know, if you're your one Native American friend who hates being called Native American and rather be called Indian, whatever.
She's listening.
Good. I just insulted her.
Good.
By calling her a Native American, which is politically correct. Anyway, yeah, you could be an Indian. They fucking went to war with each other while they were being hired as mercenaries for the white guys. And, of course, you know, we also slaughtered them en masse. So, like, you know, and forced them into fucking no man's land reservations. This is what's taught to me.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't like, oh, wow, this is perfect and this was, you know, the invading force. It was like, no. Everything was a giant shit show, and this is what happened out of the fucking mix. That's what life is. It's just a giant shit show.
For me, it was very matter of fact. Like, this happened, then this happened. It wasn't over emotional or over. We learned about how they, you know, how Indians, Native, whatever.
I mean, yeah, there were those people that romanticized, you know, Pocahontas and John Smith as this great romantic thing. But when it came down to it, Pocahontas was just a fucking backstabbing social climber, and she fucking saw an end to getting with a, well, better crowd, and fucking took it. And then she, whenever the guy fucking passed away, she married someone richer, married right up. And yep. Went back to England. Wow.
But, so, I mean, we learned about, you know, different cultures or whatever, but yeah, it was always very, you know, matter of fact or whatever. I don't, like I said, I don't know what they're teaching in class now. I shudder to think.
I have no clue. But just looking at everything coming down as this dichotomous framework, it's like either for or against. Whatever happened to humans being human? It's like no one is ever perfectly awesome and perfectly flawless, and well, no one's ever perfectly vile and corrupted.
Yeah, well, they're going to learn that probably the hard way. But, yeah, as of now, I mean,
the only way you learn it the hard way is if you get targeted after proclaiming yourself to be part of the perfect crowd, and the perfect crowd turns against you. Don't be part of the perfect crowd. Be part of the filth crowd. That's why I say join the gutter.
Yep, but I remember when this was first being talked about, and everyone said, this is way too extreme, you know, because it's very too absolute. This is more of like an art project than any sort of political movement.
Yeah, and now it's being taught in schools.
At least there's some pushback. That's the good thing.
I mean, fucking shit. You sit there, Yeah, the GI Bill helped people get homes and shit, you know, but then, like, you know, a bunch of black people were initially discriminated against because that was the era it came up in, and things changed slowly over time. Do you go through this whole change thing?
So,
I mean, fuck.
The whole thing about CRT is that it kind of inverts what everyone else thinks is racism and says that actually policies are racist and then they make the people racist. It's very strange. Because the system's racist, that means you're racist. And if you're not trying to topple the system, then by default, you're actively racist because you're helping a racist system. That's kind of in a nutshell what CRT is.
Yeah, and that's just complete bullshit lines of thinking. The problem, you have to sit here and look at problem legislation from, okay, how the hell do we fucking solve this? Is there any benefit to this? No. Okay, discard it. But there is a little bit of a benefit to something. Okay, does it help the masses or just a select group? Okay, if it only helps a select group, do we need this select group for anything?
Yeah, but Jim, you're not a hippie, therefore you're part of the capitalist system. You're not a communist. You disagree with what we say, therefore you're put to death. You're not, you know...
I worked my way up from homelessness to having a roof over my head. Yeah, I'm not in the most ideal situation now, but fucking shit, going from wondering if I should go down to the local gay club and suck a cock so I could get money for bus fare to a fucking shelter that was rumored to have a bed. Not confirmed, just rumored. You know, this is something going on because I'm fucking hungry. A couple days without eating, sleeping under a bridge does that to you.
It's very cult-like.
But no, I never fucking suffered a day in my life because I'm part of the problem.
Exactly.
And then people laugh at me whenever I say I haven't seen my kids in over 15 years. What the fuck? You know, I gave up my rights because I was homeless and I did not want them to share in my fate.
Yes.
You know, there was no other option available to me. I mean, I hear now that we had open adoption here in PA, but at the time the judge told me we didn't.
Yeah.
So if I was lied to, then that's even more on me because I couldn't fucking afford a lawyer because guess what? Homeless.
Yeah, homeless can't really afford lawyers. And it's very cult-like. That's the point I was trying to make, is it's very cult-like. If you're not exactly on board, then you're the enemy. Drink the Flavor Aid.
God.
I wish they'd drink the Flavor Aid.
But I just get so sick and tired of this. Like, yeah, I'm used to the fucking death threats. Yeah, I'm used to people pointing and laughing at the fact I fucking went through hell and still have suffering I go through on the daily. So, fucking what? You know, I've gotten used to this, but I just see it over and over again. You know, there were these couple kids. They got on TikTok, and they're like, hey, you want to come hang out with us? Like, we'd like to widen our circle of friends to more than just the two of us. It's like, fine dandy, okay, I can kind of understand, okay? Back in my day, yeah, sure, you would have been made fun of because going to the mall, going to the roller rink was an option. Now that's not really an option. So I could see why you'd be fucking posting a video online asking for people to fucking hang out with you. You know? And then everyone just started fucking attacking them. And it's like, great, you're going to make fun of some fat kid for asking for friends. And his dorky little friend over there, you're going to make fun of him for, you know, just saying, hey, you know, we'd like to have a few more people to hang out with just so, you know, we can have some good times and shit.
Well, I mean, what's wrong with that? I do it in a more subtle manner just on the internet, just by talking to people and say, I don't advertise, which is... It's not really
a bit extreme, but at the same time, what the fuck? I mean, we're used to going balls deep and extreme with things, so, like, that's what you really want to do. Go extreme, then. Fine. Yeah. But, like, you know, all these fucking hyper... We want to include everyone, but these people are stupid, so we won't include them. We'll mock them for putting forth the effort to try to say, hey, look, well, this is what we are, and you want to hang out. You know, that's just all they were fucking saying.
Just because it's not my style doesn't mean I'm going to, you know, make fun of it.
And like I said, I would have only made fun of it back in the day whenever there were obvious other options. Now those options are kind of ripped from you. And they have been for years before this fucking virus shit hit. You know, because, yeah, like, well, fucking everyone got divisive. You can't really tell who you could trust anymore because there's backstabbing social climbers. Plus, you have people, you know, seeking glory and, you know, ultimate victory by claiming that they were the most victimized. So, you know, they might just use you for more victim points. So, yeah, I could see where, you know.
Well, it's not even that. It's also that malls are going away because people would rather shop online, and, you know, so you, it's not like you can hang out.
The other physical activities are hard to keep open because fucking you gotta have interest for people to go, and people aren't into roller skating as much as they were back in the 90s. And they're gonna close.
And CD stores are gone. Mm-hmm. Albeit we still have a couple. So, options for hanging out are limited, so I can understand this. Like I said, I do it a lot more subtly just by, you know, talking to anyone I can about anything. You know, I you remember in 2015 I jumped on your show because it had the word metal in the title. I didn't know who the hell you were.
Posers. Then you found me.
Well,
and the jury's still out, which is good.
I was in the group because Mason added me, but yeah. I had never looked at the group, right? It was just a group I was in. So I didn't know who you were. I'd heard the name Kamikaze before, but I knew who, you know, I didn't know who you were or who Scott was. I literally just joined because it has the word metal in the title. So I took a chance.
Yeah. Kind of funny. So you're willing to take all these stupid risks because some fucking boomer once said socialism was a good idea, so now we're going to teach everything through the socialist lens and everything's power dynamics and bullshit dichotomies for or against.
And that boomer who said socialism was a good idea probably voted for Trump.
Probably. I'm
just saying. It's a cycle. It's a cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another thing, too,
you know, fucking shit. Kids not realizing that one day they're going to be the ones in power, because I'm not going to live forever. You know, Gen X is going to fucking die off sooner than later.
Actually, I'm going to put your brain in a robot.
Oh, God, no. I don't want to be immortal. Why must you make me suffer more? Well, then again, if I get death ray eyes, yeah, that might be worth it. Immortality, as long as I get death ray eyes.
No, being immortal, and you know, that's actually, I don't mean to go off topic, but that is something nobody can understand, is because everyone's, I want to be immortal.
God, seeing people repeat the same mistakes over and over again.
We're seeing it right now, just because we have access to history.
No, fuck, I lived through the 80s, and we're, like, kind of back there already with all the fucking racial tension, the fucking people bickering back and forth. My God, the fucking annoying feminists today are the same as the annoying feminists back then.
There's even a mini satanic panic, although the Satanists are fake atheists.
Yeah.
Fuck, that is so pathetic.
But you got it, you know, like, fucking shit, we've had riots and shit before. God, what the fuck do you think boomers did when they were the hippies?
We've had police brutality. Remember Rodney King?
Mm-hmm.
Poor Rodney. He couldn't keep out of jail if he wanted to. I mean, this is nothing new. It's, you know, that's something I always thought was funny, was people talk about what horrible, you know, this is a horrible time. If you had Twitter and Facebook and access to the news in the 80s or 90s, it would probably look as bad, if not worse.
Actually, there were parts of it that were worse. There were parts that were better.
But, I mean,
could find a clique to hang out with, you know, regardless of how scumbaggy or fucking Puritan you were. Now it's a lot trickier because everything's just trying. Holding on to one's own ethics is a bitch. In today's society, it's like, you gotta sell out something or else they're gonna eat you.
Well, we even have Cold War paranoia now that everyone's afraid of Russia again.
Or China.
Or North Korea.
Yeah, North Korea is back as a player. Oh my god. When was that ever going to happen? Fuck.
Interestingly, a couple months ago, both of us read a book called The Accusation. Well, I read it. I think Jim read it.
I read about a third of it. I've heard some of this shit before, but not, you know,
not as specific
and not as, like, wow. Yeah.
It's a fascinating, I mean, it's really depressing, but it's fascinating. It's stories about life in North Korea. I recommend reading it at least once.
Yeah. We have a recent defector. I fucking forget her name, but she's been making, like, talk show fucking tours online. Say, like, how she escaped North Korea and, like, you know, what the fuck happened. And, like, her opening story was, like, yeah, one time they just decided to let the entire northern region starve. Because...
mm-hmm. And
there was probably, like, one suspected fucking capitalist there, so the entire region had to pay.
No. It gets better, Jim. Because during times of famine, they issue propaganda in newscasts counseling people not to eat too much or you'll explode. And so, at least in the 90s, cannibalism was rife. Sometimes on still living people.
Oh, good.
And... so the first story of the accusation is about a guy attempting to leave the country because his father accidentally destroyed a thing of rice. Okay, so that meant he was marked for life. His kids were marked for life. His grandkids were marked for life. I mean, that's just one. Yeah,
and his wife secretly took contraceptives so that she would not give birth to a child. Yeah, that too. So that she would not give birth to a child that was going to be marked for life because, you know, what point is it to bring a kid into a world where it's just going to be hated?
Well, from birth. She was seeing what her nephew went through, you know, who was a bright kid, a very smart kid, but all of a sudden it's like, oh, you're one of the, you know, you don't have any power anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Or the kid who was afraid of Karl Barth's posters. So his family was exiled.
The best part was the chick, the wife was in fucking very good standing with the party. Her father was a martyr, so, like, she was in very good standing. Like, she could get away with, you know, bad-mouthing people. But that was the final straw. You can't have a kid crying over a fucking poster.
And putting
poster.
Up curtains.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it goes on and on. My favorite was still the train story where the Kim before Kim Jong, Kim Il-sung, picked up the old woman who was walking because the train station was so crowded because the private train, which he wasn't even riding, and closed down the entire, you know, rail line. And she had to thank him for, you know, saving her from the horror that she caused. Mm-hmm. So it's quite an interesting book. I mean, it's really depressing, but it's sometimes the best books are depressing.
Yeah.
And I mean, according to people who've, you know, read the book, I mean, the stories are fake, but the situations are real. Like, something like that really did happen. So, that's... the whole thing about... Like I said, the whole thing about you're either with us or against us is, like I said, it's very cultish. It's disturbing in a way that I don't think a lot of people understand. I mean, to just brand everyone who isn't 100% gung-ho like you, a racist, is, you know, they
very exclusionary.
I hate to Godwin this, but they did that in the 1920s, where the communists didn't even like the social democrats because they weren't as left wing as the communists were, and the social democrats and communists fought, and the Nazis gained power, and finally the conservatives, to shut the communists and the social democrats up, handed Hitler power in 1933, because the conservative, you know, the old line conservatives thought, we can control him. He's going to shut the communists and the social democrats up, and then we can control him because he's a little extreme, but, you know, he's going to be our puppet.
Yeah, that worked out real well. And
exactly.
Everything's democratically elected, too. How quickly you democratically elect tyranny whenever think chips are down. I mean, you got to remember the situation that was there, too. Fucking inflation out the ass, complete economic collapse.
Kids used to play with banknotes because they were completely worthless, so you would give them to your kids to play with, because what else are you going to do?
Exactly.
I mean, it was horrible. Italy was doing a little bit better, but Italy was also extremely fragmented, and that's kind of why Mussolini came to power. It wasn't quite the same, but yeah, Germany was... If you want to read about something interesting, read about the interwar years, especially before the Nazis came into the Weimar Republic.
One thing about this for us or against us mentality is the fact that it usually brews the people against you to unify against, and they'll probably get the worst actor possible to do so, and then your entire movement's squashed, but by something far worse than what the hell you thought you were fighting.
Well, look, that's, I hate to say it, but that's why Trump got in, because so many people were sick of the woke.
Mm-hmm.
So they picked, I mean, rather, I didn't, thank fuck. I voted for Jim Thompson.
That's right.
But the thing is, people were so tired, they went completely the other side and picked a clown.
Mm-hmm.
So It's going to get a lot worse. So, just, we were talking about, you were saying that you were also tired of people saying that, you know, white privilege or whatever, that you would have had it a lot worse otherwise.
Yeah.
Because you would have been dead, apparently.
Oh, yeah, I would have been dead. God, that's endurance, not fucking anything. Fuck, will to go.
Well, you refuse to give in.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
You refuse to give in to your enemies.
There was a guy by the name of George Washington Bush. He had traversed the Oregon Trail. And for those of you that don't know, the video game at least gets the death rate right. A lot of fucking people died on that trail. It was a fucking death march to the promised land.
Yep.
And he was a guide. He made that trip multiple times across death. Disease, all kinds of shit.
Yep.
So whenever he finally decided, hey, I'm going to hang up the trail and fucking move on in, Oregon had this thing called lash laws, where basically, blacks were heavily discriminated against. And he was black, so he was like, fine, I'll just move up north here where these laws don't exist, and he started his own community. Eventually a city sprawled out of it, you know? And then, because of that, the whole damn thing, America was able to tell Canada, hey, look, we got enough Americans up here, this is ours. And that's how we got the state of Washington. But
yes, Washington Territory originally, and then it became a state.
But, you know, the kicker was it was annexed by Oregon, which meant the lash laws followed. Well, his entire city pretty much petitioned the federal government saying, no, this guy deserves his land. He deserves to be able to hand it off to his descendants. He deserves all this shit because he did all this shit. Complete. And fucking Congress acquiesced and said, here. At a time when it was unpopular to do so, fucking Congress said, okay, there was enough of an outcry, we're just going to do this.
Well, perseverance should always be a virtue.
Yeah, but now it's all give up and cry till someone else fixes the problem for you.
I hate to use a racing metaphor, but Jim, you know that's like the only thing I know. Look at Wendell Scott, the black guy who raced NASCAR in the 50s and 60s. Okay? He was from Virginia, racing NASCAR in the 50s and 60s. Now, Jim, you don't know much about, like, NASCAR, but the South in the 50s and 60s was not a very good place for a black guy to race against other white guys.
I can understand. There was a lot of things why people were probably lynched for that they shouldn't have been.
He was once...
That was a horrid time, but, you know.
He was once told to leave a track immediately because fans wanted to seize his race car and burn it. He was denied entry to several tracks, including Darlington. But did he give up? No. He kept racing until basically a huge crash at Talladega pretty much ended his career. But he kept coming back and coming back. He won a race, got a couple, like over 100 top tens, because despite all the bullshit he had to go through, he had enough respect in the racing community and he loved what he was doing and he wouldn't, you know, stay away. And he had to earn people's respect. I mean, because like I said, it's not only racing in the South, you're racing against white drivers. Mm-hmm. So he had to deal with, but he just, I mean, I just finished a book about Roger Jack, a black racer from the 1930s in California, which is a little bit different than the South in the 50s, but still, he had to deal with a lot of, you know, but he went and he won several races.
God,
just,
you know.
Despite the fact that the AAA refused to grant him a license because, you know, he was black, he won several races. He was an early favorite of famous racing promoter J.C. Agajanian. So perseverance should always be a virtue. You should never just give up. But unfortunately, this society likes to give up.
Yeah, it does.
Which, well, and the thing is, if you say that, then you're hyper-masculine.
Oh, God.
Toxic. Because you can't conquer anything anymore.
I hear that.
So that's, I mean, yeah, you have to basically just give up and cry and hope that something saves you.
I'm just reminded of, you know, people that had the deck stacked against them, because the entire situation was where they were set up to completely fail. Okay, and that was because, oh wow, you know, black guys flying planes in fucking wartime is, like, you know, not good and bloody bloody blah, but, you know, and then the Tuskegee Airmen were, like, you know, one of the most requested fucking fighter escorts that bombers asked for. They may have sustained losses themselves, but they never lost a bomber. And they flew missions over Germany during the height. that's like fucking hell infested, like you're going to die, and they still didn't lose a bomber. And for those of you that don't know, a B-52, the only thing missing from a B-52 was like a giant sign saying, shoot me out of the air. Because those things are fucking huge. You would miss the broadside of a barn than fucking miss a B-52.
I hear,
a single one was shot down.
I hear they're going to retire the B-52 in about 30 years, meaning it'll be a 100-year-old plane. It's that good. But okay, so but
it's huge. That's the thing about thing with it.
The thing about that, Jim, is it's not even that the black guys flying planes. What are fighter escorts? They're cannon fodder.
Yeah.
Because your job is to protect the bombers and probably get shot down.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they thought. They thought, oh yeah, we'll use these guys as cannon fodder. But they did a great job.
And so great, they were requested.
Yeah.
And they were taking down aces, which were like things people didn't do that often.
B-52's a little bit after World War II. The plane you want is the Flying Fortress.
Okay. That's what I was thinking of. Sorry.
Yeah, the Flying Fortress is a gigantic plane. I have a model of it somewhere around here. We saw one flying the other day, and it was being shot down regularly because it was, I mean,
huge.
it's a huge bomber. It's not designed to be, you know, maneuverable. So, like Jim said, they had the fighters mostly in P-51 Mustangs, which was a great plane, and
you gotta remember this is like 1940s tech, so like, you know, no fucking radar out the ass, not even a rear view mirror. You had to fucking cock your eyes around 360.
Maybe a little basic radar, but nothing even remotely like we have now.
Yeah.
But and yeah, they did a damn good job. I think George Lucas made a documentary about those guys.
Yeah.
So, but you know, apparently,
I mean, but you know, the deck was so stacked against the fucking racial tensions and all that bullshit, and they outperformed. You know, don't strive to be people who outperform those saying you can't do shit. No, just cry and curl up in the ball and do nothing and never be exceptional.
Well, look at me. I'm blind. I mean, how many people have I told you, can you dress yourself? Can you bathe yourself?
God.
So, you know, here I am, host of my... Granted, the only reason I don't upload things is, you know, is because Jim records it. If I was recording it, I would upload it and, you know, just get a thumbnail or whatever. But Jim does the visual stuff because he can see, but I do some, you know, all those little solo stuff, I stream and upload them by myself.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody else does it for me. And hell, I could probably do some of the visual stuff if I knew what I was doing. You know, if I had software that could tell me what was happening. So, but apparently I was just supposed to curl up and not dress myself or whatever.
Yeah, and let everyone do everything for you because boo-hoo, you're blind. Yeah, fuck that shit.
Yes. So...
It's like, yeah, I should fucking curl up in the ball and cry because, you know, I grew up in a mental institution. I got problems. Ooh, wow, I shouldn't try to get a job, do good for myself or any of that. No, no. I've got things that let me go on Easy Street and get SSI, which is bullshit.
Well, what about Alex Zanardi, the racer who in 2001 lost both of his legs in a horrific crash in Germany? What should he have done, Jim? Just sat at home and cried?
Or fucking figure out a new way to do it.
He was back racing within 2 years.
There you go.
He's also done stuff at the Paralympics. Jim's done stuff in the Special Olympics.
Yay.
People have asked about that because they heard something. Yes, Jim has actually done stuff in the Special Olympics.
I medaled in the Special Olympics. Every gold was a fucking hard fought. It wasn't like, oh, wow, I'll tell you one thing about retards. The ones that look like they come from the Ministry of Goofy Walks, the moment they hit the water, it is like a fucking torpedo. You have to go. I don't know what happened, but they go from being barely able to move on land to zoom. And as soon as they hit that water...
Wow.
So every gold medal was hard fought. And I tell you what, I only kept one participation ribbon out of all my losses. Swimming, no matter, fucking skiing was a lot. I fucking sucked at skiing. You know, I only kept one just so it's like, see, look, I even got one of these. The rest I pitched. You know, I didn't care about them. It was just, you know, to have a sick joke while I was fucking partying, you know. But I kept all of my, you know, golds, silvers, bronzes for the longest time until, you know, I ended up going homeless and lost everything. But, you know.
I did.
But I took great pride in, like, even placing third because the competition was that stiff.
Mm-hmm. I did the Braille Olympics for kids. I mean, there was an older Olympic thing, but I did the one, you know, basically for young kids or whatever. And I got a couple silvers and bronzes in running, of all things. But they gave out participation medals, but I never understood why. Like, why should I get the – I showed up, sure, but, you know. Yeah, I never actually got a gold, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But I only did it for a couple of years. But
you see, when it came to track and field, I sucked at that. I didn't usually place. I mean, I didn't even do the shot put. I did the softball throw.
No, I sucked at shot put. Running was the only thing I was actually.
That's how pathetic I was. I didn't do the shot put. I did the softball throw. Yeah, that's hardcore athletics. And the competition was stiff for that too. I remember this one time, there was this clown there, and, you know, he was sitting there making fun of us, and, like, everyone was throwing, you know, a good 5-10 feet in front of him, you know, and I was like, fucking bastard, get the hell out of my way, and I whipped the ball straight at his head. He ducked out of the way, got scared, moved out of where we were throwing to do his routine then, and the next guy was like, thanks, I didn't want to be an asshole. And he threw about a good 10 yards further than my best throw.
Nice. So, yeah, I was good at running, of all things. I didn't really try much of anything else, but I got a bronze in the basically a shuttle run, which is, you know, you run backwards and forward, you know, you run and then turn and then run and then turn, you know, something like that. And I think I got a silver in one of the 50-yard dash or something. I would have gotten a gold, but they tripped me up, fuckers. They said stop, and I thought the race had been stopped, but I don't know. It was weird. So yeah, I did that. But participation medals, yeah, I've never really understood participation medals. I've always just thought they were.
The whole thing is, you know, even, you know, fucking sitting there in a fucking partial program and shit where I should just cry and give up and let other people do it for you. I fucking fought competitively for shit that, especially swimming, that was my thing. God.
It's like do you remember the Olympic guy who, like, was completely unqualified for everything and finished last and had no chance? I mean, it wasn't even like he tried. He had no chance of anything and people applauded him. I can respect someone who at least try. Even if you finish dead last 12 laps behind, if you try,
yeah, you know, you can get a good applause for that.
I can respect, but if you're, I have no qualification. Well, it doesn't even matter if you have qualifications. I have no qualifications, but I have no motivation to at least try to do something. I can't respect that.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta fucking at least try. Take the chance. Even if you lose, fuck.
Even if you finish last, even if you're completely off the pace, as you know what? You gave it your best try.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, fucking shit. Everything's all about, you know, you gotta take the risk every now and then. Don't fucking sit there and cry because, oh my god, what if I fail? Yeah, well, what if you succeed? I mean, and fucking that brings me to the fucking piss ant, the one that did the fucking My Useless Life thing that we did way too many hours of. I twisted
Elliot Roger.
Yeah, that piss ant. Fucking, I still think the better title for that was Putting Effort Into Anything Is Lame.
That is a great grindcore song title. Yes,
because literally everything was like, I did this, I liked it, but then I gave up because people were better. It's like, why the fuck do you think made them better? You think they started off at the top? God, that's rare. That is more rare than there are people at the top. They don't start there. They start at the bottom and work their way up.
Even if someone's better, even if you've reached your natural zenith and can't do any better, you know that you've tried your best. But yes, practice makes perfect. Some people are not natural at what they do. Some people need practice. But so friends come to me for relationship advice. God only knows why. And, you know, some people are afraid to get into a relationship because, well, what if it ends in disaster? Well, what if it does end in disaster?
What if it's what the if, one, and what you're if it passing doesn't? It up?
What, I mean...
I mean, so what? Fucking what? I failed a lot.
Me too. Not as much as you, because I'm not as old.
Yeah, you're not as old. You didn't spend a decade chasing the same chick who just wanted to find someone that could financially support her instead of love, no, like she said.
I only spent 3 years. Anyway, continue.
Yeah. So anyway... But, it's like you fail a lot, but I learned from those experiences. And one thing I noticed was with online dating, okay, going to the sites, I could word a very good profile that would catch chicks' attention with the perfect picture and everything, and I get all these hits. And they were all not worth my time.
No.
So I started to jack it up, and now mine reads like a complete sociopath wrote it. But it filters out all those people who aren't worth my time, and the couple that do reply, I at least get something out of it, you know.
You post a carcass picture on your fucking thing, and people actually start asking you because it's unique, it's different, it's wild, why do you have that? And then, people who, I mean, yeah, there's going to be some posers. You know about the chick I thought was going to be metal, but turned out to be, boring and afraid of you, of all things.
Yeah.
That I love. And then she stopped talking to me when I showed you your writings. but there's others. And then there's the one that I fucked up. And I take complete responsibility for fucking up. But she talked to me because I had the cover of Reek of Putrefaction on my Facebook. Okay? And and it was different. Or... there was one other where I answered a question in a very snide way because I thought the question was, trying to get attention. It was like, do I think, am I too fat for love? And my answer was, if you think you are, then you are. Okay? Which is because, now, I like big, and you know that I'd like, we've talked about this, but I hate attention. I hate people who just want attention. So, that was my... it was snide as hell, but it got someone's attention.
See, I've dated a full range. And I'll tell you one thing, never dated an anorexic. It's all about control. Run. Do not marry an anorexic. It will be a nightmare.
Well, I go the other way, so, yeah.
But anyways, fucking shit, you fail. And, I've gained knowledge from my failures. And I've seen what works with other people. I've seen people in long-lasting, loving relationships, and I've noticed what works for them.
What was the Evel Knievel quote? You're only a failure if you don't get back up, or something like that?
I don't know, but that sounds about right.
How many bones did that guy break?
All of them, multiple times.
Yes. I mean, I read about 3 books about him over the past, because, it's fascinating. But anyway, yeah, he said that something to, you can fall many times, but you're only a failure if you don't get back up. And that's how I've always lived my life. I've had disappointments and people, left and things collapse.
So I'll sit there, maybe spend a week, crying, getting over it, readjusting. Then I'm like back and fucking doing whatever. Well, if my heart's crushed, fine. I'm not going to fucking sit there and try to rebound. So I'm going to sit there, work through the emotion, get back out there. Because, love's like that really cool thing,
Well, I'm not immune to that. There was the one time I'm like, I rarely ask for this, but could we, hang out? Because I need to get my mind off this. Mm-hmm. And we did, and it was fun. But it was, I was not...
You played DJ, and I told you fucking weird stories I didn't say on air.
Yeah. But I
think I've said them on air now, but back then I don't think I did.
But it wasn't like, boohoo, pity me. I was like, just, can we just, have some fun?
And, once in a blue moon, I do go into that boohoo, pity me thing. You know what snaps me right out of it? When a friend tells me, shut the fuck up, Jim. Just go fucking get a beer or something. I don't give a fuck. Set something on fire.
Well, you've seen me go from boohoo, pity me to... it's all bullshit anyway. Let's party. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were talking about... I'll go into it for maybe a day or so, but it was just... It's... Yeah, it could even be somewhat therapeutic, but you've got to snap out of it. You've got to just
roll around, get on with life. It's like, oh wow, you know, I got lost my job again. What the fuck do I do? Get a new job. Okay. So now I'm fucking promoted.
It may seem demoralizing.
Granted, I'm only promoted because no one's showing up to work. Thank you, people, for staying at home.
Yeah, they got a I told some people that, and they got a kick out of that. He's just the least lazy.
Yeah, I'm just an ounce less lazy than the people not even showing up. Or the people coming out, showing up for a day, and saying, oh my god, there's fumes. Yeah, we're working in a plastic factory. What do you want?
Yeah, right. So, and granted, it might seem demoralizing, but, you know, what else are you going to do?
Mm-hmm. It's not, I mean, like that's something I learned whenever I was fucking homeless, you know. You gotta fucking get back up on your feet. Always get back up on your feet. Even if you gotta crawl and use that fucking rock beside you as support, and then maybe pull yourself up on that wall as you slowly start to stand, and eventually you're just wobbling there on your own feet. You at least got that far.
Now, I'm not saying that as soon as someone dumps you, you should, like, immediately start playing the field. I'm not saying that. I mean,
yeah, and sometimes you want to take, you know, a day or two to fucking even say, oh god, I lost my job. I like that. That sucks. I want to sit here, relax for a day, then I want to get right back on fucking finding a job. Or you wait a week, get a day. I say a week's a good time to fucking get over everything, because there's going to be some emotional shit you got to work through. But, you know, after a week, you know, you're back out there dating, you know.
I can tell you that after You Know Who left, I did enter into something, and I realized that I wasn't quite ready. So I said, hey, we could still talk, but just wait a couple, you know, just, I need to sort something out. I sorted it out by myself, and she was like, yeah, okay, I understand. And then we got, you know, back into it. But I wasn't quite ready for something serious yet, and then I sorted it out, and I was.
Uh-huh.
So,
dating. This is like all facets of life. You know, what if fail at, you know, doing this thing, or getting this career, or fucking trying out this new sport, or fucking going out there and fucking, oh god, I can't even tell you how bad I suck at first person shooters. But eventually I adapted after my friends killed me 6 times on fucking James Bond GoldenEye 64. I adapted and I found a playstyle that suited me. It was suicidal as hell. I used a missile launcher or grenade launcher in tight, narrow corridors. It was the suicide bomb method. Because you lost 1 point for the suicide, but you gained 1 point for each kill you made. So the thing was to try to lure people into a nice, tight firefight, then blow myself up and take everyone to hell with me.
I'm sure your
friends would net me 2 points every time I killed 3 people. Not including myself, because obviously I have to go.
I'm sure your friends were thrilled.
Yeah. In fact, they had this one guy that was boasting about his abilities, and he was pretty good, but he was so snobbish. It's like, fine, release the gym. And the guy's like, oh my god, that's such a dick. It's like, yeah, but I used the game mechanics to my advantage.
He doesn't play fair.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, they could. I mean, they never tried just picking you off first. Like, okay, get rid of him first, therefore he can't.
No, I knew that they were going to try to pick me off first, but then they'd see each other and they'd start shooting each other for the quick kill, and then all of a sudden, boom! Oh yeah, Jim was there. Oh my god.
I don't know. I've always been too stubborn to give up.
But the you blood see, of... you know, you learn, you adapt, you roll the punches, you find what you can do. Sometimes you get really good at what you can do, and it just works. You know, other times, you know, you end up sucking. I still suck at first-person shooters, but goddamn, I still have fun with them.
Yeah, sometimes you learn your limitations, and, you know, you learn what you're good at, and learn what you're not. I learned that I'm a much better speaker than writer.
Mm-hmm.
So I do this now. I don't do the blog anymore. Which, I mean, the blog was fun, but it was atrociously written. And yet I actually had people reading it. How strange. So, but you can't give up. You need to, you know, kill your enemies.
Mm-hmm. Bathe in the blood of your enemies. That sounds like a good plan.
That does. We'll be right back.
first one was Man O' War with Blood of My Enemies.
From the Hail to England album, released in 84.
And the next one was Marduk, Beast of Prey.
From Panzer Division Marduk. And by the way, this is a usual reminder, if you like the music we play, support the bands.
Mm-hmm. We tell you the damn names and albums and all that shit for a reason, boys and girls.
Yep. Remember, all I want and all I need is to see my enemies bleed. Mm-hmm. I was just thinking, because, you know, people will probably be surprised by our talks, people who may not, you know much about us. Yes, we do make jokes about how big of failures we are. This is actually when we're being serious.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I like the drunken failure stuff. It's fun, and I like that, you know, my favorite comment is, you know what, kids? Don't follow your dreams, because you might end up like me. Which is, you know, which should probably strike fear into their hearts. But in reality, I'm, you know, okay, I'm not exactly where I want to be, but I'm doing what I want. This show. I'm, you know, doing some video game stuff. I'm reviewing some music.
You see, I am nowhere near where I'd want to be. But dear fuck, do I enjoy life for the most part. Well, yeah, there's things that piss me off, but there's things that fucking depress me. There's things that agitate me, things that annoy me. So fucking what? Oh, God.
Okay, well, in truth, I'm nowhere near where I want to be now, but where I want to be now is, you know...
When you're younger, you could actually make something of yourself.
Rip shot. No, I mean, I'd rather be in a bed surrounded by, you know, 30 satanic slots. Unfortunately, that's not happening, so...
I just want to see the world on fire. I want my post-nuclear war wonderland. You know, where I survive and then have to survive. And I wonder, is that area radioactive? Because I don't have a Geiger counter or anything to tell me that if it is or isn't. Am I going to die of fucking cancer? And being irradiated to death?
or it turns out that Fallout was right and ghouls are real.
Oh, that'd be awesome. I don't have a cock anymore, but I'm wrinkly and dead. This is great. Now I get to piss off the world again. And then I go feral and try to eat people.
Yeah, but they can still... they still somehow find ways to fuck. At least the... So, yes, and I become a robot, of course.
Yes, we all want that. The laser death eyes, that's the selling point.
So the robot blind kid and the ghoul Jim travel around the desert solving crimes in a dune buggy.
This crime has been solved, but you just killed the person who wanted you to solve it. They did it. What's your proof? I shot them.
Frontier justice.
Fuck, that's not even frontier justice. That's just pure... I don't give a fuck. You can't even qualify that as vigilantism. I'm sorry, that's not vigilante even. The guy who said, please help me solve this robbery. Bang! Robbery solved. He's the one who stole it. But he...
It's like decapitating people so they won't steal before they stole.
Yeah.
The guy with the problem was obviously the culprit of his own problem. Problem solved. He's dead. We hope you enjoyed this life lesson.
Back to the dune buggy.
Note to self, don't trust undead guy who acted out of his skull on more drugs than we can count.
Raul was like, you know, the good ghoul who, you know, killed people who preyed on the weak. Uh-huh. You're the complete opposite of that.
Well, it's not even preying on the weak. It's just shoot a person because I don't feel like doing the work. I'm too damn lazy. Bang! There, problem solved. Next case. I don't want to be the next case if that's how he's going to go about it.
But so, I mean, you know, I hate motivation posts, but in some way we're probably more positive than some of the positive people who try to put on a brave face and smile every day.
Consol Stepford's smile, at least we're genuinely doing it.
Yeah, I mean,
or at least I'm genuinely doing it when I'm not at work.
Well, that goes without saying, but it's not like I've done some things that I, you know, and made mistakes, but you just, and now I, you know, have someone who's pretty awesome, Jim, you know who I'm talking about, and
that's pretty cool.
I'm doing a show again.
There's no ounce of jealousy there, because fuck it. Finding the right chick for me, it's like I gotta find someone who mixes well with my psycho, but then, like, realizes I grew up, but then also wants to pray. It's a complex mess.
Yeah. It's.
But that's life. It's all a fucking shit show.
It is, but. And she listens to the show.
Good.
She even likes the show, which makes me think she's insane.
Yeah, now don't do what this one girl I know did, okay? Do not fucking shove a taser up your twat. Even if you're into electric plate, just don't do it.
Well, I used to listen to this show called the Mudbomb Radio Show. Jim, you've heard a couple episodes and heard me talk about it about a gajillion times.
Mm-hmm.
The Mudbomb Radio Show was really my sort of inspiration for wanting to do a show. It was more about celebrities and making fun of everything, but, you know, the general attitude of misanthropy was still the same. But anyway, one of their clips was, and I was like 14 when I heard this, was from a website called electricityplay.com.
Sounds like a winner.
And they said it was almost too disturbing to show. Which, I mean, the Mudbomb Radio posted fart porn.
Yeah.
So, I know all about that. So,
the chick I know who literally can't get off unless you throw her down a flight of stairs because she needs that much pain to get her pussy juices flowing, she has sent me a video about some chick into fire play and once her entire body engulfed in flame. That's... not long enough to be fatal, you know, enough to even suck up all the oxygen, just her entire body in flame for a couple seconds, then put out.
That's awesome, but, like...
very dangerous.
Way too scary for me.
It's something, I don't know if I could do that safely. I don't think I could.
I don't even think I know I couldn't do that safely. Then again, you know the weird stuff I've been to, so...
yeah,
we've talked about that, but yeah. That's not fire play. That's just messing with your mind.
Yeah, it's fucked up shit, and it's all fine.
It is, but I mean, it all comes down to trust, basically.
Yeah, you know, I just want to go off. You know, I'm gonna say it right now, and say now that I've gotten old, everyone that's now like in their 40s and shit. Is a conservative by default, because we all have that good old days we want to strive for.
Well, I mean, I'm not saying I'm getting more conservative. I doubt that, but I am getting a little bit more, like... So, last year, when the whole riots happened, someone told me she was living quite near where a riot was happening. And a couple of years before, I would have said, well, go down there and join them, man! But, you know, last year it was all, oh, are you okay? Stay safe.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, what the hell?
We've taken risks in our youth. It was good. But, you know, at some point you start finding people you value, things you value, ideas you value. And you just keep going with it. And it's like, yeah, okay. And now you have more defined, ethics, more defined morals. as you get older. And it's like, ugh. And I find out that, you know, yeah, there's very few, but once a line's been crossed, you know, yeah. There's going to be hell to pay one way or another.
Just don't go completely the other way, you know. Always remember that, you know, you were a scumbag once.
Yeah, I know. Well, duh. And, huge part of my morality, which is like, yeah, well, there's always this path to redemption. Well, there usually is.
Well, you say, well, duh, but how many people have... Well, maybe you haven't, but I've met a lot of people who went the other way and even found religion, but they forgot that they were a scumbag. They were saved.
You see, I flirted with that whenever I was married, just because, you know, it was either do that or lose rights to my kids. Lo and behold, I lost rights to my kids anyway. Just because I had the past. on top of fucking being everything wrong, born the wrong way, whatever. Fuck the people.
Yes. But, so, there's people who do forget. And people who...
You know, after that, I just remembered, oh, yeah, and I gotta roll the scumbags if I'm gonna do anything that's gonna be good.
And some people who, while they remember, they still go completely the other way. And, oh, I can't talk to you anymore because you had a song called Fuck Christ.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Or,
really?
You
don't think God's heard that before?
Or you cheated on your spouse. I mean, granted, I'm no fan of cheating, but it... You know, you can't just... That's the thing. So, how many people have you known who've cheated? I'm not asking, you know, how many people... I've known a couple people, and people expect you to just end whatever friendship once you realize that, you know, wow, you did something scummy. You can't just turn off how you feel about someone.
Yeah. I mean, fuck, you know, back in my fucking 20s, I cheated on a girl a couple times, and yeah, I felt horrible about it. And I never did it again after the last time, which was, well, one chick was once, and the other chick was twice. And after that second time, it's like I never did it again because I fucking beat myself over the head. It's like, you know, God, I think I might have had the one that time, but, you know. Whatever, you know, life changes, whatever, you know. I made my own bed, I sleep in it.
People do dumb things, but people, you know, you know, you're supposed to be basically stoned to death if you do something stupid. As opposed to, yeah, you did something dumb, and we might call you out, or we might say, wow, that was a shit thing to do, but it's not, you know, it's not the end all, it's not the end of the world. Yeah, forgiveness is a dying concept.
Yeah, it is.
There's a lot of dying concepts. I think we've tackled about 12. But, I mean, that's just the sad thing about this society, is it's...
That's happened before. We've had this fucking shit every time. The one younger generation starts moving up and starts getting their place in power, and another one's just starting to come of age into adulthood. We always have this fucking vacuum era, and then, like, crazy shit happens, then, like, things get stable.
Yeah, but the hippies thought the punks, you know, the punk generation was so horrible because, you know, they had, you know, menacing clothes and songs like I Kill Children.
Let's go eat some baby. Yeah.
Feed us a fetus. And then, well, actually, I don't think the punks really cared after that because We've been getting soft ever since. I mean, after the 80s, it's just it was new metal, so.
Oh God.
And we've been getting softer.
There's not much that's more weak and pathetic. God.
Oh, there's a
classical
lot.
Classical music's got
pathetic.
Fucking more edge.
There's a lot that's more weak and pathetic than new metal. Not that I like new metal, but you haven't heard new metal mixed with deathcore. And the skinny fucks who listen to it. So
look at me, I'm such a trendsetter. Not like I didn't have to put up with those when I was in high school.
Or the people trying to combine black metal with shoegaze. Because I want to be different.
By all being the same.
Well, yeah, and not actually shocking anyone.
Yeah.
I hate Death Heaven, but when I first heard it, did it shock me? No. It was just boring.
Disgusting, and God, why? Why do you drone on so long, and you wrote a fucking manifesto about this?
When I first read about black metal, it was shocking because... So, I understood even when I was 11 or 12, the death metal, they were generally nice dudes who played aggressive music, right? I mean, you watch an interview with Cannibal Corpse and they're fucking teddy bears.
Uh-huh.
You read about black metal, regardless of whether it's true or not, this is not, we're not talking about how they are now, but what do you read about black metal on Wikipedia? Oh, yeah. Murder, death, murder, church burnings, murder,
arson.
Yeah. Regardless of... I mean, I now that I know a lot of the black metal people are really cool, but I mean, back when you were 11 or 12 and reading about it, it's like, holy shit! It was actually shocking, like, that this actually happened. That people actually did, you know... Yeah, Vikernes has stabbed his bandmate to death.
Uh-huh.
So, that was actually shocking. Death Heaven wasn't shocking, it was just awful.
Uh-huh. I think the manifesto about it was even more awful. God.
Liturgy, yes.
Oh, that's the one I was thinking of.
The burst beat. The burst beat is life-affirming.
My testicles are life-affirming. Allow me to teabag you as a blessing.
I actually had a dream where I was walking down an abandoned hall, running away from your voice, reading out the manifesto. The burst beat. Oh my god, no!
Not again!
Hyperborean black metal. Get away!
Run away! God.
Granted, I also had a dream of my own personal vision of hell, which was just locked in a padded cell with your voice reading Elliot Rodgers' manifesto.
Oh, God.
Well, that's
I saw people who were better. And then I spent, like, thousands of dollars on lottery tickets and probably didn't even do that correctly by making certain they were all different numbers. I probably just did all quick picks.
I wanted to skateboard, but I couldn't kickflip, so I was so mad that I even hated being called a skateboarder because I couldn't kickflip.
He decided to go on his temper tantrum with a gun, you know, fucking he tries to run over skateboarders. Because apparently those skateboarders could do the one trick he couldn't. How dare you? Got it. It was just a fucking crybaby temper tantrum with a firearm. That was it. It wasn't even like I'm cold and calculated. It was, why are you better than me?
He was supposed to do it the next night, and everyone was, why did he change his mind? I think he saw something that pissed him off, because he was not a very stable person, and he wasn't like Timothy McVeigh. He was the Oklahoma City bomber who thought his plan out carefully, right? Uh-huh. He was a very impulsive... He probably saw a young couple or something, or a skateboarder kickflipping.
Yeah, oh my god, a kickflip! How dare you insult me by being able to do that one trick without even me knowing I'm watching you? How dare you?
Yeah, so
The party scene. Oh god, that was hilarious.
The party scene, I actually have the party scene saved. I don't have the document anymore because the old computer broke, but I didn't want to re-download it, but because it's too pathetic, but I actually do have the party scene saved.
This guy walks up to you while you're sitting there flinging the chicken, and he just starts rambling on and on drunkenly. It's like, dude, just settle down, chill. We go outside, get some air, it'll be cool. And you finally talk him down, and he goes outside, and then he starts trying to push people off a porch.
Yeah, I mean,
how the fuck do you treat this guy? I think walking with a broken legs they pushed you off the porch was, you know, very, very light, my friends. Yeah, all four of your limbs are broken and you have to dig your own grave now. But I can't use your mouth then.
Yeah, first, okay, dude, you're drunk, calm down. You know, that's because everyone's gone that.
Everyone's fucking done something stupid while they're drunk. But then you fucking compound it by, like, trying to fucking
push girls off a ledge.
Yeah.
On it was like a 12-foot ledge onto the street.
Mm-hmm.
And so they pushed him off. No. My favorite was still...
He came back to look for his one thing.
Sunglasses. And it was the wrong party. So he came up screaming at them, and he was beaten up.
Who the fuck are you? Oh, wait, this is the wrong place. Ah, how dare you move the party on me?
So he was beaten up for that, which I think is very well deserved. Yeah, that is one of them. So the thing is, nobody understood why he... Because, like I said, he's the reverse Timothy McVeigh.
God, the kid was just so focused on himself as the center of the universe.
You know,
and he was supposed to be the flawless one, but every time someone did something better than him, it wasn't, oh, wow, maybe I should try harder. It was like, I'll give up.
You know, Tim planned out his attack for months and set everything up and sort of knew he was going to get caught, but took precautions to not, and, you know, was able to... By the way, how was it to die in the Oklahoma City bombing, Jim?
I don't know. I just know that that was the reason my dad gave him why I wasn't showing up to class in college.
Oh, well, yes. So this was not some sort of master criminal. This was a guy throwing a temper tantrum.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there was a little bit of planning in him acquiring guns, but I think that he had planned out this retribution thing, blah, blah, blah. And then he saw something that pissed him off, so he flew into a rage. It wasn't planned out. It wasn't, I mean, yeah, okay, he killed like four people or whatever, which sucks, but...
It was just crybaby temper tantrum gone horribly wrong. Wow, you know. Fuck. It's... And you read through his shit, it's like, yeah, if you were to treat pussy like property, that's just fucking wealth redistribution that he was planning, you know. You keep them locked up until you needed to breed, then, like, they'd be given to the most rightful people to breed with. What the fuck?
And notice he never actually talks about, like, the personality of women. All he wanted was a hot blonde. I was like, get a blow-up doll.
Yeah, and the thing was, like, they had to be perfect and totally into him. And I guarantee you that, like, lots of chicks probably flirted with him, but he took it as, like, some sort of slight.
Well, because they weren't blonde, or they were, you know, not his idea of attraction.
They wore a 9 instead of a 10.
Well, and he was only attracted... Well, also, he was only attracted to a certain type of, you know, girl, which is funny, because he was talking about how... You know, I saw my roommate with a girl and she was ugly, and I was like, yeah, but seeing as how you're only attracted to one type of girl, ugly could mean she's like a hot black girl or something.
Yeah, really.
But, and, you know, besides, I'd rather have personality than...
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
that's one of the reasons why I started dating chubby chicks for a while there, was because the personality was far better than that of skinny chicks.
Well, yeah, plus it's just better than bad.
Yeah, there you got that, too.
So, yeah, that's... I probably... So if you're still listening...
Yeah, let's have some fun.
Yes.
Speeding one horse, not from the
All right, the first one was Vader with Distant Dream.
From the Black to the Blind album.
And the second one was Gorgoroth with Under the Pagan Monolith. From, Megalith, sorry. Pagan yes. Megalith.
From the Pentagram album. I really like the vocals. I know they're a little bit, you know, like love him or hate him, but he sounds like a bird of doom. Too bad he only recorded that one album. Yes, Gorgoroth from the Pentagram album. And, of course, Vader's from Black to the Blind. Two fantastic albums. One death metal, one black metal. So I was just thinking about, I mean, part of this show and part of what I try to do is be honest. I mean, especially the communities I'm in, you know what I'm talking about there. Mm-hmm. You see a lot of people who try to hide that they're involved in these communities. Mm-hmm. Not because they're illegal or anything, but because they're, you know, different. Shameful.
Yeah, shameful bullshit. God.
You know.
Hey, if well, you were just... You sit there and you look at it, and everyone's got to put on this face to keep their job. And is your job really worth it? If you got to deny yourself happiness.
It's not even the job.
I mean, it's one thing if you got to put it off till, you know, got the weekend or maybe a month or so, you know. Maybe half a year because you got to wait for that vacation time to roll in, you know. That's delayed gratification. But if you got to deny yourself constantly this one thing you want, is it really worth having that job?
It's not even the job. Some of these people are activists in feminism, and yet they...
Well, that's kind of a job, regardless if you're paid or not.
Secretly. So, for me, I mean, it took me a while to be more open about it because I was very self-conscious. And I was, you know what, I'm just going to do what I do. And the same thing with, I mean, I know people who try to hide that they're into metal in 2021. Because what will my friends think?
You got the wrong friends then.
Yeah, you do have the wrong, yeah.
So if you're surrounded by a fucking bunch of shallow sycophants who are only with you saying yes because you appear to be the way that, like, they want you to be, what the fuck's the point? You're not even being yourself.
No, and I mean,
you're being so false if you're guys will be like, oh, wow, I gotta hide all this shit. I mean, yeah, while I'm at work, different person, you know. I don't fucking speak my mind that much. I get home, it's like, yeah, fuck this shit, and I don't care whose feelings I hurt. And I've gotten into fights with girlfriends. Hell, I got in a fight with a girlfriend recently. You know, and it's like, yeah, well, what the fuck? You know, I just don't like this thing, and this is why. And it's like, oh, wow, whatever, you know, it happens. And we'll probably make up in a couple weeks, and whatever. Or maybe not, I don't know.
Granted, the stuff I'm into is, as you said, pretty fucked up.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it's, you know...
I mean, shit, I sit here and openly state on air, you know. I like the daddy's little girl fantasy, the dirty daddy little girl thing. It's not because I want incest, it's because I'm playing with a taboo. It's strictly that. And there's a certain dynamic with, like, you know, everything going on there. And it's, like, fucking weird and fucking wild, you know. And recently I started realizing, yeah, maybe I could do the fucking mummy's boy thing, too, you know. But it's not like I really want to fuck my mother or I really want to... That's disgusting. It's yes. More playing with, like, you know, the dynamics and the fucking, you know, forbidden nature of it and all this other shit.
That's why you read... That's why there's, you know, incest stories. It's not that the author really does want this. It's a, you know...
I mean, my dad used to get a thing called the Pennsylvania Family Connection. Of course, in case of my dad, it's debatable whether he wanted to or not with my sister. I mean, that's debatable because, yeah, he was that scumbaggy that he might have. Because I've heard of instances where he walked in on her in the shower and shit. And it's like, yeah, that's kind of pushing boundaries a bit there, Dad. And I could see, like, once in a blue moon because you really have to piss, but to just go in, grab something, and leave, you couldn't wait, you know. But anyway. Yeah.
See, I'm glad.
You know, most of the things there, you know, were, I could tell were purely fiction because the setup was just like complete bullshit. There was only like one that I thought was like, maybe that was legit, and they thought they were reaching out to a community that understood whenever this is mostly role play.
Yeah. I mean, and I've told you about some of the stories I've read about. Yes, you're brainwashed into wanting to breed with your brother.
Yeah.
I mean, that's disgusting, and yet...
Yeah.
I think that would actually explain a lot of these ideals. They've all been breeding with their siblings, and that explains this generation.
Yay! Fucking your family. If you can't keep it in your pants, keep it in the family. Captain! Oh, God, you took me seriously. No!
And we're allowed on YouTube. That's the best part. YouTube's cracking down on everything. Yeah, for now. Well, I did jokingly suggest we move to Pornhub. Unfortunately, Pornhub's cracking down on non-porn.
Yeah.
Which is really stupid. I mean, I think it should be... I mean, what is pornography? It's anything that's forbidden, isn't it? I mean... So...
Actually, that's another thing. Even the fucking vanilla porn. When has the, you know, repairman ever come by and banged the wife, you know? I'm certain it's happened, but, like, you know.
Oh, I'm sure it's happened, but...
How often? Not as often as they depict in porn. And, oh, dear God, don't use porn as sexual pointers. Don't do that.
Not even in my
life. You have to learn where the clitoris is. Trust me on this, guys. And there's nothing you gotta trust me on. If you get her off first, then you go in, it feels so much better. Don't do it with a virgin. You know, you want to deflower that nice, you know. And, you know, maybe a little gentle, because, you know, fuck it. And then she'll just sit there and cry, you should have been rough with me the first time, whenever she gets into it rough. But, you know, that's neither here nor there. Now, the main thing is, you get her off first, then you go in. Even if she's had, like, four kids, it's nice. Tight. Good. And it also increases her chances of having multiples, which does weird things with the muscles inside. So, you know, double the pleasure for you. While you're giving her double the pleasure.
Swine Brothers 6 talk.
Yeah.
Sorry. Thank you for the advice. That's something you can trust him on. Don't take any of his advice about anything else, but you can trust him about that.
Yeah, I can tell you how to fuck proper, boys and girls. My ex-wife taught me, and then I learned more from there. And this is just the vanilla shit I was talking about. I wasn't talking into other fucked up shit.
Well, even in my line, you can't... Well, at least with my line, you can't actually do most of the things that are depicted. Thank fuck.
Mm-hmm.
But you can sure imagine it. And roleplay it. Yes, yeah. In my line, the repairman will actually be some sort of insect creature, and anyway.
Yeah. Well, it's not like I haven't seen my fucking share of tentacle insect vor porn.
Yeah, but it's missing the mind control aspect.
No, not really.
Oh, well, that's good.
You are. Because like she's like no, then all of a sudden give me, and I can't get enough, and I gotta fuck everything now. And by the way, I'm growing a dick now for reasons I can't explain. And then, like, she loses the dick, and it's back to... I can't even describe it. It's, like, fucked up. And this is what the tentacles do, is she shits out more tentacles. And the tentacle babies that she has start raping her to make more tentacle babies.
Yes. All I'm going to say is you are a nest. Anyway,
Yeah, I'm a hive of filth.
Yeah. Well, that's... I mean, but that's the one thing, is be honest about what you like and what, you know, who you are. I'm not saying everywhere. I'm not saying do it at you know, at work or whatever. But hell, I mean, might as well just. I mean, I don't hide, you know, what I'm into.
I already went into way more description than you probably wanted about the things I'm into. And it's probably giving you nightmares, which I say good.
How many stories have I sent you? Like, you gotta check this out, this is so weird.
I was like, yeah, that's pretty fucked up.
Yeah.
Of course, you know, not everyone had my dad's porn collection.
Did he have spider porn? That's all I want to know.
No. Okay. That didn't come on until I started going online. I was like, yeah. Holy shit, this is, wow, that's... And then I saw other things that were fucked, I was like, oh, wow.
I mean, granted, they were alien spiders, but still, the idea of...
I have seen pictures and video of girls shoving literal maggots into their real-life orifices.
Isn't there a picture on the Swine Brothers intro of a girl eating a bug?
No, there was one of her fucking a bug, but that was like a drawing, not like...
Oh, okay.
And it doesn't show anything vital, so you could take it as a deep embrace, maybe.
I've gotten many comments about the intro. It's like, I didn't do it, it's Jim!
Mm-hmm.
And the music, by the way, is made by Genie from Ye Goat Herd Gods.
Oh, what's funny is the one picture that's actually motion, because it was a GIF. Graphical interface, not GIF. It's GIF. It's a graphical interface. Anyway. Sorry, that was a pet peeve because I heard people saying it wrong because they didn't know what the acronym stood for.
Anyway, the music is made by Genie from Ye Goat Herd Gods, which is probably the Swine Brothers' official band at this point.
Yeah, good shit.
Amazing. Just pure, just amazing. Both albums are fantastic. I can't say enough good things about them.
Which is good.
And great people, too. And that's, I mean, I know plenty of people. You know, I know we've tread this path before, but the idea that if someone, you know, if someone's an ass, then you can't like their music.
God, really?
One of my favorite albums last year is from a band called Drop Dead, okay? I love that album. It's ferocious. I told you, it sort of makes me remember why I got into punk rock in the first place, and it reminds me why I miss being pissed off. I hate Bob, the singer from Drop Dead. He's an ass. He's a militant. He's a militant vegan. He's not a very nice person. But does that stop me from enjoying his music?
I mean, it's well documented over the years how much of an asshole Mustaine is, yet we've already stated countless times that Megadeth won over Metallica in that war.
Well, yeah, I just wouldn't want to, you know, run into him.
Yeah.
But yeah, Mustaine's a prick, and he's been a prick for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
Albeit at one point in time he was a funny prick.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, fucking. I hear that James has to. What was it? James has to teach Kirk all the new parts. He was so venomous. But the idea of if I disagree with someone, I can't enjoy their music. If their music is very political, I don't agree with Drop Dead about anything. But I love the album. I love the ACXDC album. But I've had run-ins with the lead singer. So there, I mean. You can like music and not disagree with someone. Look at Mustaine. Look at, you know.
God, if I only listened to things I politically agreed with, dear God, that list would be like down to like one, maybe just like instrumentals.
Look at Lars from Metallica. Can you name a bigger asshole than Lars?
God.
I mean.
Oh, God. The cause of so much trouble and strife everywhere. I mean, not just for fucking, you know,
fans of the band or within the band itself. No, fucking people that don't even listen to metal have had to suffer his wrath.
Everyone knows Lars is a dick. But yet, those first four Metallica albums, well, first two, three, four, whatever. I'll be nice and say four.
Yeah, I'll be nice and say four.
I love them. They're awesome.
Uh-huh.
I mean, for, you know, what about all the vegans playing grindcore?
Uh-huh.
I love Napalm Death. So that's... The problem here is absolutes. There are no absolutes.
We're all humans. We are all fallible. And I think that's a major problem that even translates into, like, modern works of fiction and why so much of it sucks is because people get so caught up in writing the perfect thing. Or, like, you know, if it's a villain, then they have to be, like, you know, misguided or, you know, something sympathetic instead of just, yo, I'm fucking evil. Fuck
Where's
you.
You can write sympathetic villains, but it's very hard to. The Damnation Game wrote a very good sympathetic villain.
Mm-hmm.
I reread it a couple of months ago.
Oh, yeah.
He was a great sympathetic villain. He didn't
best line. Best line in the book. Shit and semen make the world go round.
Yeah. He didn't even like what he didn't even like that he had to do it, but he ran out of patience.
Mm-hmm.
And he hated the people he had to deal with. You know, I mean, Breer was the scum of the earth. He was basically a pedophile.
Mm-hmm.
He killed his kids or whatever. So, there's all sorts of... But he was... You felt sorry for him. Whereas most people who try sympathetic villains, it just gets into... My daddy was mean to me.
Oh, God.
I thought Mary Sue's were a bad thing. I mean, so... One of the things I do when we're not swining is I read Sporks. I don't know if you know what sporking is.
I kind of remember, but tell the audience.
Sporking is basically making fun of a book. You don't quote the entire book, but you summarize it and, you know, laugh at it. It's basically like Mystery Science Theater, but for books. It's something I read like a quite a bit of, because I think it's hilarious. And, hey, I don't have to read the whole book to see how bad it is. And anyway, I remember when perfect characters, perfect leads who are infallible and can do nothing wrong, I remember when that was a bad thing.
Okay. We've both endured the horrors of Fallout 4.
Ew.
And I want to do, like, a fucking little fan thingy with it. Because there are some ideas I want to explore there, but the writing is so horrible, it can't even convey what it wants, let alone anything interesting. Yeah. You know, but there was something I found looking deeper and deeper. It's like, yeah, there is something interesting there, but you're framing it totally wrong. So, and what I want to do is I want to take four survivors out of Vault 111. One's obviously got the Sean. The others are just other survivors. They start off as friends, and then things fall apart as they each side with different factions. And, of course, the one thing is, the one guy is going to be pure good guy, idealistic, you know, gung-ho, I'm going to save the world and all this shit. And he gets the idea, maybe if I recreate a government that's better than the last one, it'll be better. And then he goes to nuke a world. Holy shit, oops. I have an army now. This is while Santa Claus is beefing up the fucking Minutemen and other people doing everything, and the moment he comes back to start invading, let's just face it, even though he thinks he's making it better, he's bringing fucking raider clans into the area, so everyone's going to automatically oppose him, because everything he's doing is against what they're for. But he's thinking he's doing the right thing, just, you know, playing lip service to the lesser evil so that way we could confront the greater evils which caused the destruction of the world.
Yes. That makes sense.
So even though he believes he's incorruptible, he's already beyond hope.
Yes.
And I still write, I'm still want to write it where, like, you know, he goes through like a positive change arc as this is going on, but now it's too late. He's made these decisions. So now he has to figure a way to cope with them, you know, and all this shit. And that's just one of the characters, and a couple of the characters go through a negative change arc and, you know, just start, you know, buying more into bullshit, getting more ideological. And Santa Claus goes through a positive change arc because he's going to be the pacifist that just snaps. Like, he doesn't start off as, oh, wow, I'm Santa from the North Pole. No, he's just a pacifist from pre-war who now has seen too much violence and snaps and decides to become Santa because who's going to stop him?
Exactly. Well, I was, you know, I told you I was reading the Soul Rider saga earlier in the year. And what amazed me is that the characters have flaws. I mean, there's the, you know, they go through periods of depression. They go through periods of uncertainty. The one badass is so cynical, and yet he knows he's cynical. So he's like, yeah, I'm pissed off because it happened to family. But if it happened to somebody else, I'm smart enough to admit that I wouldn't give two shits. I'd probably do it to somebody else. You know, all the horrors that are going on. And he's like, I've probably done worse to somebody. But the fact that it happened to my family, that pisses me off. So he knows that he's not perfect. And yet, you like him. You want him to do well. Even the villains. You don't... Except for like the two sociopaths. You even kind of understand why the villains are doing it, except for the two that, you know, just like causing evil. But they're fun. They got the good guys to, you know, turn basically. So they had these rockets that were going to be used as space buses, which is a cool con. But they had a problem, Jim. The space buses had a problem. They didn't land very well. In fact, they shattered into millions of pieces when they landed. So that would probably be fatal to the people on board. So they packed the space buses with explosives, and they started lobbing them at the government.
Oh, that's good.
Yes, it was beautiful. So there's depth in those five books. There's character arcs, there's, you know, periods of depression, there's periods of uncertainty, there's periods of, holy shit, am I actually going to die? Nothing's perfect, and I like that nothing's perfect. You know, we caused a revolution and it went back to the, you know, the old ways, or even worse than the old ways. Oh, look, now there's a revolution, well, what's next? Now that the second, you know, you just never know what'll happen. But nowadays, it does seem like everything either has to be ultra-political or everyone has to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Which, again, what's wrong with character development?
Yeah, I know.
What's wrong with, you know...
Starting off flawed, or, you know, you can even start off perfect, but you become flawed as the story goes on, and it starts becoming more apparent that you're... And that's what I'm trying to do with at least one character where, yeah, she was perfect, but then she met an idea and just took it to an extreme and became corrupted.
Hell, the Stiffy McCain fucking game that I played, which if you listened to a couple previous shows, you know what I'm talking about. That had more depth of character than Fallout 4, because basically Stiffy only did his thing in the main quest in the game because he wanted to fuck a goddess.
Yeah.
And then it turned out that the goddess was pissed off at another guy, so she redirected him to sodomize the guy with the golden banana of discord. It makes sense. So you try it, you get put on trial, and you get turned into a sexy pumpkin. By the way, never piss off someone with 100 dicks.
Yes.
That advice is for free.
That advice is for free.
So, but, I mean, as simplistic as that sounds, that's more... You want to side with the Institute or the Railroad?
It's always the Institute.
Well, yeah.
And out of everything there, it's like, okay, you see, the Minutemen, yeah, but they can ally themselves with anyone. Why do I have to pick them exclusively? I mean, they're actually doing something good, although they're a personality cult that will collapse the moment it loses its charismatic leadership. So you better side institute so you can put a synth in your place, and then that way you don't die.
At least you can decide. I was reading a defense of the Enclave from Fallout 3.
Well, yeah, I can see why you would want them sympathetic, because they are attempting to make things better. Just really fucked up, but yeah.
Granted, the president and some of the others were insane, but there were voices of reason in that one. At that side.
It's just horribly written, so that you don't get to see the full thing, but I get the ideas, you know.
Yeah, but even...
I mean, after the second one, anyway. The second one, yeah, that was pretty hardcore. We're going to destroy humanity.
Yeah.
To save it. We're destroying humanity to save it with a bunch of inbreds. Enjoy.
That makes perfect sense. Actually, I would just give the entire world to the swamp people from Point Lookout.
Yeah, they need it more.
I think they should just have the world.
Mm-hmm. They're what's best for the wasteland.
Yes. Yes. I'm glad you agree.
So, let's go on with another sermon.
Okay.
All right, the first one was KK's Priest with Sermons of the Sinner.
From the yet-to-be-released album Sermons of the Sinner, that's KK Downing's new band, He of Judas Priest fame, with Tim Ripper Owens, ex-Judas Priest singer.
Off of Ashes Shall Be Made of Them, that was Ye Heard Gods with Arduous March.
What a great band. What a great album. And, you know, it's fun. I mean, we're, friends or whatever, but I'm not just saying that to suck up. I remember when I first heard that album, and it was so many amazing riffs.
Oh, yeah.
And they're melodic without being, unheavy.
Exactly. Yeah.
Amazing.
So they even use a little bit of groove every now and then, and it's not like, oh, wow, this is a crush. No, they actually use it as a tool to get to the next thing.
Yes. It's
pretty cool.
It is. Yes. So, just thinking about, like I said, various things that we were talking about.
We've been all over the place. It's great.
You can take Jim's advice when it comes to sex. When it comes to, how to deal with your enemies, probably best,
Oh, you know what the funny thing is?
What is the funny thing?
Out of the... let's just take my high school bullies, for example. We'll call them enemies. Out of them, the ones who apologized are still alive and doing whatever they can for themselves, whatever. The ones who never apologized all died. But I didn't lift a finger. It was DUI, car accident, fucking drug overdose, other stupid things they did to themselves which caused them to die.
Yep.
So you either said, I'm sorry for what I did in high school, or you died of your own accord. So yeah, my enemies are pretty much dead. And I'll probably outlive you too.
Yeah, it works.
My single lung, thanks to me smoking 2-3 packs of cigarettes a day.
Yes.
Everything just fuses. I'm probably like fucking Lemmy at this point. My blood's too toxic for other people.
Yes. Lemmy said that he went to go get fresh blood, like Keith Richards was rumored to do, back in the early 80s. And they said, you can't have fresh blood. What do you mean? You don't have human blood anymore. It will kill you. You also can't donate blood.
It will kill everyone else.
Yes.
That's a good thing.
He was basically a mutant.
Yes, I wish to be a mutant too.
And he lived to be 70.
Abandoned the human species, joined the mutations. I think that's one thing I don't think people grasp whenever we say join the gutter. It's no, you don't have to fucking sit there and revel in fucking all the fucking drug abuse and all that. No. Just assume the mantle that you are filth. And from there, you can either be the light and shining in darkness or the fucking most vile person ever. It's not a statement of, oh, wow, you have to be like this huge fucking drug degenerate. Sure, you can be, but you could be a decent human being or one of the best, even. It's just the fact that if you don't side with the prissy, high society, fucking polite society, fucking bullshit, you can just be yourself.
Yes.
Without the need to completely restrain constantly. People don't... When you're part of the gutter, people can't... Well, people will judge you even from within the gutter, but it's more based on your own actions from within, whereas everyone from outside casts out. Do you really want people that judgmental that you have to be perfect, that the slightest mistake you make, you will be hounded on 20, 30 years later by, fucking hate mobs?
That is something that people... Yeah, whenever we say join the gutter, that is something I've gotten questions. The sad thing is, a lot of people feel like they have no choice but to join polite society because that's wherever, all the jobs are and all the prestige and
Sometimes you gotta give up an ounce of prestige that, hell. There was this movement a while back, okay? They were bitching about, too much politics and random bullshit dumbing down comic books, of all things,
because they wanted, like, you know, their own kinds of, like, entertainment. So these people broke off into this thing called Cosmicgodsdie. And they're making decent money off of it, those that are making the good shit, or, you know, and get the publicity out there and shit. And it's all completely underground. You don't hear about it in mainstream outlets at all, other than, oh, these guys are evil because they blah, blah, blah. Yeah, they broke off and did their own thing underground, and it's more successful than you know.
See, this is why I wish you would have given the Daria show a chance, because then you might have actually understood. I know you thought it was pretentious. I thought it was a lot like me in high school. And I thought that was part of the point was, yes, it was pretentious, but she's learning that the world isn't black and white, which is something I had to learn in high school. Anyway, but the point of why I bring that up is because one of the things that the show makes, people are scared to not have prestige. People wear it like a suit of armor. People are scared to go underground because it's the unknown. It's terrifying for them. For me, it's the only way I know how to live my life.
Yeah, same here. It's like, fuck this shit. I'd rather fucking sit here in my gutter, enjoy myself a nice cigarette, good menthol. Mm-mm, good. Let's get one right now. Kick back with a fucking iced coffee in hand. You know, it's home brewed. You know, I brewed it myself. I just threw some ice cubes and sugar in it. That was it.
Yeah, I hate iced coffee. It's fucking weird.
Oh, I did it because it's fucking hot outside.
And
I don't have air conditioning, you know.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm kind of boiling right now because I don't have my fans on because that picks up on my microphone too bad. The new fan, which I got, is like, oh, God, that thing's like evil. It sounds evil. It's like, it's like, oh, my God. And did I just fire up a grinder? That's awesome. And it does the job, you know.
Oh, yeah, no, that makes, I mean, yeah, especially if you don't have air conditioning and I iced tea is what I drink. Oh, man.
I love me some iced tea, too, but, you know.
Yes, iced tea's amazing.
That doesn't keep me motivated like coffee. I don't know why. I've just been on a huge coffee kick the past few years.
Coffee's good.
But I still get my fucking iced tea.
I just drank a thing of coffee. But so the thing is, people are afraid. They don't understand. They think that...
I want you to sit here and remember that there are still marks of prestige in the underground. I mean, fuck.
Yeah, but it's not the same. It's not the same as,
oh my God, it's on TV. Who the fuck watches TV anymore? Seriously. Old people do, but, like, kids? Do kids even watch TV? Do they even realize that a lot of these things are dying because kids aren't watching it?
Well, then... Yeah, but the whole thing is they don't understand. Without the good car or the good job, they're afraid. They don't understand what will define them because they let that define them as a person.
You see, that's where nihilism comes into effect, kids. You define yourself.
Yeah.
And if you feel like you want to be a Christian, fine. Be a Christian. That's how I derived that fucking entire line of thought. It really doesn't matter if I worship anything or not, or what the hell I worship. Why don't I just go with Christianity? There's a bunch of rewritten shit there, and I can nitpick my way through the shit I don't like, and explain it away as fucking propaganda of the time, because it's a book written by people.
I'd also have
it's
to
not
add
like,
that
you know, God himself wrote it. No, this was written by people, and the books that made it in were even voted on by other people. Who were alive long after those books were written.
I also like to add that you can be a cheerful nihilist. Nihilism doesn't mean you have to sit on the ground going, nothing is really real.
Oh, God, that's like the first degree of poser nihilism. It's like, oh, boo-hoo, nothing matters. Then you get into the second degree of poser nihilism, which is, I am the grand destroyer. Then you get into true nihilism, which is like, oh, well, Weird Al's got a couple good songs, you know. Everyone makes fun. Oh, wow, you listen to Weird Al, but fuck it. He's actually one of my favorite musicians that isn't metal or punk.
Well,
or
there's
like different.
I know people who smile all the time. You know, a good. I mean, you may. A lot of people may not agree, but I think Moira Brown is a cheerful nihilist. Not in the same way I am, but in the way that she's just, you know, I just accidentally, you know, fed a research assistant to a Meyer lark. Oh, well, for science.
It's for science.
And she's, I mean, she's bubbly as hell.
Mm-hmm.
I know some bubbly nihilists.
Yeah. I mean, it's not all about this fucking huge hardcore attitude. I mean, yeah, I'll sit there and pose for a picture looking all mean and shit, and I'll pose for another picture right after being goofy as hell. You know,
well, you saw the picture.
Fucking listen to fucking Morbid Angels fucking all
cock. You saw the picture of me and my dog. That was like the least metal picture ever, but he's a cool dog.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like jumping on me. So
I got a picture of me looking at with the cat with pure disgust in my eyes because my girlfriend at the time took the picture just as I got a whiff of the cat's fart. And I'm like, you fucking bastard. Ugh. It was just before my face turned sour, like about to vomit and shit. And like, you just see me like giving this cat this cross look like, you fucking bitch. That's like the least metal picture of me you could, one of the least metal pictures of me you could find, but it's like me, you know. Who gives a shit, you know? I mean, sometimes I do like looking big, mean, and menacing, you know, just because it's fun. And sometimes, fuck, you watch Fright Night Theater, you see how much of a goofball I am. God.
You are. I mean, he's a cool dog, and he was jumping on me. He was like, hey, get a picture. I like the picture of me and the construction equipment, you know, the scaffolding. Oh, it was like, wow, he's in a war zone.
That's awesome.
It was at the mall, and we saw it. It was like, well, post-apocalyptic hellscape. Yeah. Well,
what was funny was they had the fucking backhoe at the one cemetery we were filming at. And I don't know why they had it there, but I was like, hey, well, let's do some of the shoot while I sit on that thing. And I'm going to be renovating hell because, you know, the devil gave me the deed to it.
Yeah, for those of you who have not watched Fright Night Theater, Jim is like a world-class ham. It is awesome.
The character is supposed to be that way. So, you know, it's like,
But I mean, there's nothing subtle about your performance, and that's not an insult. That's awesome. I love it.
That's the whole point of the performance too. It's taken as a compliment. It's like, I was supposed to be as subtle as a flaming brick groaning through the window of a fucking gas station, from the inside to the outside, so it hits the pumps. That's how subtle the performance is.
Yeah, you own.
And that's
that
how
shit.
It's supposed to be.
Yeah, it's awesome. I love watching Fright Night Theater.
Yeah, you just take over hell a few times, and then the devil kicks you out.
Don't be like Jim, kids.
Yeah, don't be like Jim.
God, we should have put that in the intro.
Yeah, I know.
Don't be like Jim, kids. But, yeah, there's a Fright Night Theater. I mean, so yeah, I have moments. Like I said, it was just, you know, there was my new dog, and he was jumping on me. I was like, hey, it's cute. Let's take a picture. And I sent it to you because you wanted a modern picture.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, well, that's the only one I have that's from, like, you know, recent times. So, I don't try to be, you know.
Yeah, I wanted that so I could make a facsimile of you in Fallout 4.
But yeah, I don't try to be nothing is really real, man. I'm me. I believe what I believe. But that doesn't mean I can't, you know, meaningless life or whatever can actually be quite liberating. It means you can do whatever you want.
Mm-hmm. And it also means you can define your own meaning for it.
Yes, because I'm in a Discord server, and I've told you a lot about this Discord server. Someone's like, yeah, you know, nihilism, man. Like, this, you know, life sucks. I listen to black metal to, you know, because it's crushing, and I listen to power metal to forget that life has no meaning. It's like, why is life has no meaning? Why is that a bad thing?
Yeah, really. Like I said, you know, the whole, I use nihilism to derive, you know, why don't I just become a Christian? Yeah. That seems settling for me. It doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things, so fuck it.
I'm still a Satanist, and I'll stand by that, because A, it's what I believe. B, it pisses off the Satanic Temple to have people like me. I know you were making fun of me for it the other day.
Yes, but I do that, make fun of you with everything I find.
Yeah, I know.
Every single imperfection I make fun of you with.
I went to the bathroom.
And, you know, that... you piss sideways? Dun, dun, dun. Oh, God. No, no. I was about to make another point, but then a story came to mind.
Sorry.
Because, like, okay. Let's get the disgusting details out of the way, okay? I was still married at the time. And my wife gave me her usual blowjob, except she went well over the top with it. And for a week straight, my pecker turned to the right. Because she kind of just broke it with that blowjob. And it was like, oh, God. Oh, God. It wouldn't, you know, hang normal or anything for a fucking week. So I had to, like, piss strange.
You're lucky I haven't eaten, or else I'd be vomiting right now.
Yes, you should be.
It's not that I'm ashamed. I'm just imagining Jim in any sort of those situations.
Mm-hmm.
You ever have one of those, like, pisses where it, like, sprinkle? Like, it's not a straightforward flow.
Oh, yeah.
Just, yeah, those are
that
really
happens
annoying.
From time to time, but half the time when that happens, it's because a hair got on my cock. Because I still got long hair. And it happens a bit more often now that my hair is thinning because I got old.
I'm
now at the point where sometimes I debate whether it's safer to sit down and pee. But I have survived well past my warranty. I mean, I'm not old, but, like, considering the things I did in my youth, yeah, I'm well, you know, I may not have the years on me, but I definitely have the mileage. I have more than the mileage. I blew the mileage. It's flipped 3 times.
And you know what's amazing?
And that was before I turned 30.
You've rarely left your corner of the state.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so funny because I watch a lot of sprint car racing, and I talk a lot about, like, the Pennsylvania Posse, which, by the way, I learned today that you're not actually in Pennsylvania, according to them. You're in Ohio, but because they're a bunch of Philadelphia people. But anyway, there's parts of Pennsylvania you've never heard of.
Yeah.
Which I think is – so I was I can tell
– My main thing is I've met people that said I've been to, like, 85 countries or 35 countries or, you know, something like that. And it's like, yeah, and everything you say is the same story over and over again, regardless of which place you went. I didn't leave this corner of the fucking map, and, like, here's my stories. It's like you've said it yourself. I've lived a life of, what, a dozen people?
Yes.
I haven't left my corner of the state. All I did was live life. I chose to take some chances, and a lot of them didn't pay out. Oh, well, you learn from it and move on. Fuck it.
Speaking of piss, I can tell this story because I'm not going to use his name, and he's probably listening, but he told me this story, and he doesn't care. I think he told it on his show. Anyway, so my friend, he was out, and we were chatting, and it was outside, right?
Uh-huh.
And you could hear it was outside, and he was smoking up, as you probably are right now. And he's like, oh, I have to take a piss, but I don't want to go back inside because it's really late. I don't want to, you know, wake anyone up. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So he unzips and attempts to piss. And just around that time, a gust of wind picked up.
Yes. All over yourself, piss.
And I heard it all. Oh, fuck. Oh, fuck. I just pissed myself.
Yeah, but that's what happens. Well, you know, my buddy Jeff, rest his soul. Whenever we used to have parties out in his basement and shit, like, fucking hell. There was a point in his lawn that was dead. Nothing would grow there because everyone puked and pissed there. He had to start making a rule. Now, you have to go down to the tree line to piss now, okay? Or open this thing and piss inside the drain here.
Yes.
Or, you know, can't piss right here off the porch because everything's dead and it's not growing back no matter how many times my parents seed it. And they're getting pissed off.
And, you know, the funny thing is, being the true friend I am, my first thought was, oh, I wish I was recording that.
I know, right?
I'd have played it.
God, it's like when the self-proclaimed useless piece of shit, okay? He was known for jacking people out of their money, you know, because he always tried to run that scam. But he was always around because he also knew other dealers. Anyway, he was walking up to my attic one day, and my shitter was broken so people would piss out the window. Well, he was walking up while someone was pissing out the window, so someone aimed at him. And he was completely fucked out of his brain on drugs, so he thought it was raining all of a sudden. But he looked around, he's like, I didn't see the rain, but it was raining on me. What the? And someone pissed on him the whole way up the fucking sidewalk.
The sudden Pennsylvania downpours.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm back in Texas. And in Texas, it will literally rain for a few minutes, and then it'll be sunny, and then it'll rain again. So yeah, oh shit, I'm back in Texas. Wait a minute. Oh shit. Yeah, so that's, yeah, it's pissing outside and the gust of wind comes up.
Yeah, that's a thing that happens. It's happened to me too.
It's happened to me as well. But he just changed and was back, and we started talking about how embarrassing it was. And I was like, great. Yeah, the worst part is I didn't record your shame.
Oh, I wish I still had the audio I wish I had the audio recording to begin with. I would have tried everything to preserve it. I would have even uploaded it online. You would have loved it. I mean, most of it was just like, you know, the TV was playing in the background. You hear some mumbles in the background from us. I was in Jeff's basement, and his one girlfriend called. And he hands me the phone so he could go take a piss. So I just start talking smack about him left and right. I forget what the fuck I said, but it was all, like, horrid shit. And he comes down and hears this. And like, he's like, Jim! And I'm like, she says that she won't talk to you if you kill me. Oh, I'm not gonna kill you, Jim. I'm gonna maim you. He pulls up from behind his back a crossbow. And like, she says that she won't talk to you if you make... No, 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 no! Pink! Ah, that fucking hurts! That fucking hurts! There's a crossbow bolt stuck in my ass! Oh my God!
You embarrassed him in front of her a couple times, right?
What?
You embarrassed him in front of her a couple times.
Well, not just him, a bunch of people. Like different girls, different things. Like, oh God. This was like the most petty thing. I was going through like maybe what wound up being just like a 3-month dry spell dating, okay? Or maybe 6 months, I don't know. But it was a really short dry spell, okay? And Jeff suggests I go off to his cousin's house so he could flirt with this one friend of hers and I could try to score with his cousin because he didn't give a shit. I'm like, cool, okay. So I try that, and of course his cousin's turned off on me and she even starts flirting with Jeff. So I'm getting pissed off, thinking, oh my God, he's getting all the chicks and I'm getting none, blah, 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 boo-hoo, blah, blah. So I walk over to him, grab him by his neck and lift him off the ground. Within a split second, he whips out his butterfly knife, twirls it around, and starts gashing my wrist. Then I go, ow, drop him, and start walking out the door. About 10 minutes later, while I'm walking down the highway to walk home, you know, I'm done fuming and all that, he pulls up in the car and, like, says, hey, you want to lift home? Yeah. And it was like nothing happened.
Yeah. That used to happen to Megadeth all the time, you know, back in the Samuelson Paulin days, where Chris Paulin used to piss everyone off, and his guitar tech got so pissed off at him, they stopped the bus, and he grabbed Poland and walked him on his head down all of the stairs. that is an awesome pile driver. And then left him in a ditch. That is an awesome pile driver right there. Bonk, 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 bonk. And then he came back onto the bus and it was like nothing happened.
Yeah.
I mean, we've done that. I know the girl,
you get pissed off at your friends. It's not time to say, oh, wow, I got to cut them out of my life. It's like, okay, well, what the fuck happened? Did I fuck up? Did they fuck up? Yeah, I fucked up that time I choked Jeff. It was like piss entry. And I realized it. I apologized for it later. And we all stole his parents' booze and had a good time from there.
There was the time where I was incredibly tired and I tried making some dumbass point and you got pissed off and left, and me and your then girlfriend were like, what the fuck?
And I came back, I was like, okay.
And then we did a show the next day. Another show. Another thing was, yeah, the girl who wore pink, as I explained, used to beat up Puke because Puke would make some snide comments and, you know, but then would just be like, yeah, okay, that's fine. He's only bleeding now, whatever. Yeah, he's only bleeding from three places. It's cool. Pass the beer. Don't get blood on it.
Exactly.
That's how friends are. You know, every now and then you throw firecrackers at each other.
God, that reminds me of like whenever we were playing with M80s and we'd put them in bottles just to see a shrapnel go. And I was down this one creek. And one time, Jeff grabbed one that had way too short of a fuse, but he had me holding his jacket, so I used his jacket to shield me, and the shrapnel hit him, and he got pissed off at me because I was the one smart enough to take cover. So he started chasing me halfway across town with his fucking switchblade.
And, you know, I mean, these are youthful. Now, I mean, not everything you did in your youth you feel good about. My favorite story was this was a dick thing to do. It was the garbage bags.
Oh, God.
That was a dick thing to do.
That was a huge dick thing to do. I mean, and I'll start because there was one teacher on this street that pissed us off. But we got the idea that we would sit there and every bag that was out for garbage night, because it was like after midnight, we slit the bottom and put it back down gently so it wouldn't empty. So whenever someone went to pick up the garbage bag and throw it in the garbage truck, garbage would fly everywhere. And this was the whole street, the whole length, from the top of the hill down to where it ended.
I mean,
and then the very next week, everyone had garbage cans. I wonder. Is there a single one? No. Oh God, that was horrible. I would have strangled me if that happened, if I did that to myself. I was like, you fucking, why?
I wonder if, you know, they some neighbors met each other in the store buying garbage cans. Oh, why are you buying a garbage can? Well, somebody slipped my garbage bag. Yeah, somebody slipped mine too.
Oh, you know, someone walked out first thing in the morning and saw the entire street flooded with garbage and knew exactly what the fuck happened. They didn't know who, but they knew what.
Oh, I'm sure they did. I'm sure they called for someone's blood.
But, you know, these are extreme examples, kids. But, you know, fucking shit, you know. Friends shit on each other. That's what you do. You point out each other's flaws, and you either work on them or you roll with them, you know. You don't sit there and cry because, oh my God, he's not praising me 24/7. God, that's why I always sit there and look at people whenever they go online and say, roast me. What, you have no friends? Well, I got hundreds of friends. Well, apparently you don't, because you wouldn't be asking to be roasted. Your friends would already be doing that.
And then I get banned for being too mean when I roast someone. That's the best part. Mm-hmm. I mean, ugh. Yeah, roast me. Yeah, I was in those groups. I don't remember what groups, but I remember being in them. And it was, hey, how about roasting me? And then just, really? Friends roast each other all the time. Not always with physical comedy, but, you know, with...
Well, I admit it's a bit more antisocial on my side, but, you know, not the, oh, wow, I don't talk kind of like what's actually non-social. No, I'm talking true antisocial, which is arson. Yes. Or, you know, blowing up firecrackers and bottles, throwing them down the creek.
Yes, and I just had to have someone who was, you know, looked like, you know, pretty in pink, but was actually a demon.
There we go.
And she liked to hit.
That's good. Oh, let's talk about hitting.
Okay.
We'll be right back. All right. First up was Piss Grave with Euthanasia.
From Posthumous Humiliation. I believe they're from Pennsylvania, although from the other side of the state.
Mm-hmm. And that last one was Enthroned, Wrapped in Fire.
From Armor Bestial Hell, Wrapped in Fire. Well, you were talking about someone who has that fetish.
Mm-hmm.
Although this is more of a satanic, thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, I mean, friends aren't... friends support each other. That's what they do. But it's not...
It's
not a constant love fest. Nor should it be. Could you imagine how boring that would be?
I agree with everything. Yay! Then everything falls into this monotone kind of fucking god, like a hedonist going...
Puke said some stupid things, and the pink girl slapped him, which, by the way, he deserved. Mm-hmm. Anyone who says don't speak ill of the dead, I'm sorry, he deserved the slaps.
Mm-hmm. I apologize.
They were also hilarious.
Yes, I guarantee you they probably were.
You know, because she's all pretty and pink, as I said.
Mm-hmm.
You're just here. Whose boyfriend are you? You know. Slap, slap, slap. Oh, I'm on the floor. Do you want to be friends?
Exactly.
Or, you know, sorry. Like I one of my favorites was you. So you're saying that you don't have the years, but you have the mileage. Yes, you cheated death a couple times. My favorite was your idiot dancing around an M80 because you thought. It was a smoke.
Yeah, I thought it was a smoke. I was dancing around saying, kill me, kill me. Then went off, boom, fell flat on my ass. Like, oh, I'm glad I didn't, you know, put shrapnel around. Like, I thought it was okay. Glad I didn't pick it up either. God, I was about to. Just to point and laugh.
So why aren't you dead?
I don't know. Partially luck. A lot of endurance back when I was younger, especially. Dear fuck. Don't drink beer bongs filled to the brim with vodka, kids. I did it a couple dozen times. I almost died.
That makes me sick just thinking about it.
Yeah. And there was like a half gallon of vodka downed. And it wasn't even good vodka.
No.
It was Vladimir vodka. Like the cheapest shit that was around at the time. A half gallon of it downed in like, you know, 8 seconds, 6 seconds.
I think if I tried to do it right now, I would be dead.
Oh, I'd be dead right now. I'm no longer anywhere near that good. You know. But, so you know, I had to prove how hardcore I was, and I was fucking 21 and a little kid, pretty much.
How many of those times did you pass out?
About half of them.
or blackout. Just what happened?
No. There was no blackout. It was either... Because half the time I did it, I was on acid, and I kept partying, because acid kept me going.
Yes.
So I had a little bit of immunity from passing out. But when I wasn't on acid, the reaction was always the same. I sway a little bit, this goofy smile, and my head smacks right into the fucking table, or makeshift table we made out of, like, a fucking chest that was made of plastic. With a wooden thing, drafting board on top. But, you know, my head would smack that, and it's like, okay, who wants to carry Jim down to his room?
My favorite recently, and I have no memory of this. Apparently, I said to Jim, we were playing Fallout 3, I was even sober, although I was exhausted, that the guy should be named No Legs Murphy, even though he has legs.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting. I didn't know what name he chose, and some stock name or whatever. So I was joking, like, "Oh, his name should be this." And you were like, "God damn it, his name's No Legs Murphy." I was like, "I have no memory of that, but apparently that was what I." It sounds like something I'd say.
Yeah. No legs Murphy. That's great.
Why do you have legs? But what's your name?
Okay. Mr. Jesus, fucking hero of the wastes.
By the way, in case you're wondering, viewers, most of the songs that were played were on a playlist when I was stoned out of my gourd.
Yay.
I compiled this about a week ago for Jim, and we just did it. So if you like the music, blame pot.
Yeah, you have edibles in your state. I gotta get a doctor's excuse for that shit.
Yeah. Well, because it's legal here, motherfucker.
Yeah.
It was really quick. I didn't black out, but I tried writing something about Kingmaker, how actually Octavia was the master of Kingmaker because she manipulated everything in her secret underground bunker. I was high. So yeah. I tried writing that. Anyway, another thing I hate is Voice of the Voiceless types.
Oh, God.
I probably
so they're always speaking for other people, and you have no idea what those other people actually said.
Well, I probably hate it a little bit more viscerally than you do for pretty obvious reasons.
Let's speak for the blind, because they can't... Dude, you do nothing but talk.
Yeah.
I can't get you to shut up sometimes. I just want to strangle you for 5 seconds worth of silence.
Well, the feeling's mutual, but, anyway.
Yeah, I know.
Shut up, Jim, goddammit.
My God, what are you going off on this time? This isn't even an issue. What? I'll make it one then. Fine, enjoy your one-man war.
You don't want me to be a part of it, do you? Oh, no. So, but yes, the voice of the voiceless types, the ones who try to speak for the blind and try to protest for the blind.
Yeah.
And get mad at things for the blind.
You know, one of the things I really hated was like, let's normalize mental illness. Dude, do you know what you're even saying? I grew up in a mental institution. Yeah, I'm at least a little bit more with it. You know, not by much, but enough to realize I'm a nut job, and yeah, that there are certain things you should not normalize, especially out of the major versions of insanity I've seen firsthand growing up in a mental institution. No, why are you? It's okay to be tolerant, it's okay to say tolerance and to try to give people a chance, fine dandy, but normalize, no.
Why? What they're trying to do, and it's good, it's one of those things that actually has some good intentions, they just don't know what they're doing, is they want to erase the stigma of it, and they want to get treatment. The problem that I see here, and you've probably seen this, is now everyone has mental illness.
Yeah.
Everyone has anxiety or something. I don't remember all these mental illnesses when I was a kid, but how many are genuine and how many are, you know, self-diagnosis? I mean, self-diagnosis is, yeah, I'm a diamond. I self-diagnose crippling.
My favorite is self-diagnosing bipolar. Bitch, no, you're not bipolar. You're not having the violent mood swings. You're not having the racing thoughts. I could tell that just by the way you're talking. You just, you know, felt happy one moment and something happened and you felt sad, and justly so, because it was a depressing thing that happened. And then you got cheered up by someone and now you're happy again. That's not bipolar. That's natural life. You reacted to stimuli as someone would.
Yes, but people don't understand that. People don't like
strong emotions. Bitch, you don't know the fucking racing thoughts that have kept me up at night. God. Or the fucking, you know, God, just flip of a switch, I fucking have a weird mood, and it's like, where the hell did that come from? And I try to figure out what the hell happened, and, you know, sometimes it was literally nothing. And it just popped in there, and it's like, okay, well, now I gotta outthink myself so that I can stop feeling this inappropriate emotion for the situation, because nothing has changed.
You just can't turn off your brain.
Mm-hmm.
And then... you've constructed a doomsday scenario in your mind that, and then you can't fall asleep because if you fall asleep, the world will end.
Well, it's not necessarily just a doomsday situation. Sometimes I just have way too many creative thoughts. It's like, please, I gotta sleep. Can't I think about this in the morning when I can write about it?
Yes, but sometimes, but well, that happens to me all the time, and I mean, it takes me. That's why I never nap, because it takes me so long to shut my brain off. By the time I have shut my brain off, the nap's over. Like my dad can take 5 minute naps anywhere. I can't do that. It takes me 30 minutes to calm down.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, but
and yeah, the fucking mood swings can get really violent, and like it took me years to figure out how to tame them, how to change them, and all this other shit without meds. And no, I don't advise doing it without meds for anyone.
Yeah.
Because I mean, I fortunately started off with a high enough IQ, I can burn a few brain cells doing it and still maintain somewhere barely above retard.
Yes, now his IQ is 13.
Mm-hmm. That's my shoe size.
We actually, he's not actually, he doesn't actually know what he's talking about. These are all just words that we taught him.
I'm the voice in his head.
Yes,
I don't
he's
even
not
exist.
Yeah.
You're just listening to him respond to things that, you know, only he hears.
Yeah, I could hear it when I played back the show, but no one else can.
Yeah.
But yeah, so the self-diagnosis, everything's, you know, or no, my favorite is empaths. I'm an empath. I can feel other people's pain.
If you attempted true empathy, you would fucking, you know, try putting yourself in someone else's shoes and seeing where they are, not just, like, casting on them your idea of what the fuck they are.
Yes. Much, I mean, it's like the Americans who go to the Middle East to go, you know, preach to the women, and the women are like, hey, we like it the way it is right now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, one of the George W. Bush people went to Saudi Arabia to go preach about how she's a mother and a woman, and one of the women questions was like, I don't feel like I need to get a driver's license. I'm fine with the way it is right now. So why is this person from another country telling me that I need this?
Yeah.
Which may seem weird to us, but that's how she lives.
Mm-hmm. That's how she thinks.
I mean,
I could sit here and say it's a bad thing all we want, but, you know, it's not going to change that you're not putting yourself in their shoes.
Yeah, it's not.
But then you got the other side of it saying, no, you have to live like this, but they have this trumped up idea of what it is, and it's not that way.
Yep. So, but yes, the voice of the voiceless. I mean, I remember people protesting because somebody made a blind joke on the radio, and people were protesting. There was one great one. I don't remember the context. Something about a restaurant, and a radio host said something like, well, if you got one leg, maybe you should go work at IHOP, which is a stupid joke, right? It's a joke mm-hmm. I made when I was like 3. But anyway, some woman called into the station complaining that her son has one leg, and she didn't appreciate the joke. Meanwhile, the son's laughing in the background.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the son clearly, and when the host questioned about it, you know what the woman said?
Hmm.
Oh, he doesn't. He laughs at everything. So you're getting mad for someone who thought it was funny, and then you're dismissing the person you're getting mad for because they laugh at everything. That's grade A.
It's like this. I was watching this, and like this kid one time wanted to dress up in a dress, okay? It was a boy. He wanted to dress up in a dress. And then his mom started parading him around for a year as he was trans. He's like, I don't want to be this anymore. I want to be a boy.
How many times have we played a girl in video games?
I know, right? Fuck.
And how many people, wow, that's so great. You're so secure in your masculinity. Or you're, you know, you're whatever. It's like, I picked a girl in Kingmaker because I thought it was funny. I thought mm-hmm. it was funny to have this all powerful, you know, named after all my friends. We picked a girl in Fallout 3 because we'd done a guy in Fallout New Vegas.
Uh huh.
And we picked a girl in 4 because we had done a guy in 2. And
Yeah, you know, it's like whatever, you know.
I fucking some.
It's like, you know, why the hell would I play Tomb Raider? You know, it's got Lara Croft. Oh wow, fuck.
I've played video games.
And then I played Legacy of Kain, where it's like, well, you know, one guy's not even a dude anymore. He's a wraith.
I've played text adventures with women. I played one where you could adjust your gender, and I once played it as a woman just because I thought it was funny. We played Magical Fucking Diary.
Uh-huh.
Long Live the Queen wasn't that girly.
No.
But people, wow, you're so brave for playing as a girl.
God, it's not brave. It's having fun. Get over yourselves. Shit. It's not making a huge statement. It's people having fun. I mean, telling you right now, sometimes I want eye candy. Sometimes I want to, you know, see what options are available to the woman that's not available to the man. Sometimes, yeah. You know, that's the only way I could play the game is as a girl because it's a female per tag. Wow. Big whoop.
Except I usually make them lesbians. But that's just...
And then you got, you know, me, whenever I like Dungeon Master fucking, you know, games, it's like I play all genders, even made up ones.
It was just to confuse you. You and your then, me and your then girlfriend, we swapped genders. She played the guy and I played the girl, and that confused the fuck out of you for a while.
Yeah, it did. And it's like, and I'm gonna go hump her leg. Wait, okay. Okay, so she's gonna go as the guy now is gonna go hump the chick's leg while the chick is murdering,
masturbating
the
with a skull.
Yeah. Just murdering the fuck out of her. It's like... And then there was I'm Real Vorkot. That really tripped me up, dude. Because it's like... You just assumed... You consumed her flesh and then became her in your own warped mind. Yet people still knew you as Retta Big Bad. But now you're Vorka. And you're going to get murdered if you don't address me as such.
Well, because the thing is, for those of you... So we played Pathfinder, and I was a goblin. And we met a goblin who was a cannibal. And I thought we'd be friends, but I rolled a natural one, and we had to kill her. So I consumed her, and I was like, well, she's pretty cool. So I think I did a couple jokes. It was like, you know, Vork is pretty cool. I should honor her legacy. We went out to pick truffles. And when we came back, the animated, Vorka's animated soul
was there, and it was like, so no, you're false, Vorka.
No. So I had to think on my feet, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're done. And I think I had addressed myself as Vorka before. I think the joke was I was trying to build a new identity with the tribe or whatever, because, hey, I can be whoever I want. I killed my last tribe. But anyway, so I had to think on my feet when addressing this Vorka. And the first thing that popped into my mind is, I'm real Vorka. You are false Vorka. And I could see your brain's like, what the fuck did you...
This is great. Yeah, my brain was popping, but I was, like, enjoying it. It was like, this is completely, like, you've gone insane, and I love it.
I love it. And your reaction, this bitch stole my identity?
Yeah, I had to think of how she would react. But, like, everyone else is already in terror of you. Because you just murdered your own... And then you enslaved the new one.
Meanwhile, everyone
rejoice,
knows
we're enslaved.
Three natural 20s in a row.
Yeah. Rejoice, we're enslaved.
Your reaction, because I broke the news that we're enslaved, and your reaction, how does this happen?
I know.
God, but yes, everyone knows who Retta actually is, but no one's allowed to call her that.
Yeah.
Because she's not a magic user.
Yeah, she's just gone insane. I love that final battle with the animation where, like, Danamund hurled the fucking bomb at while you were engaged in close combat with it. Like, yeah, I don't care anymore. She could have excluded you, but did not.
Nope. I still love when we were picking truffles and we saw some bandits and the harpy came along. And I was like, yeah, there's bandits taking your truffles. So just imagine, you're just peaceful bandits, you know, whoosh, what's happening?
I know. It's great. Why I just are you framed doing... someone else. This is
funny. Why are you doing this?
Where's my truffles? What truffles? Going, ah, don't lie to me. I kill you. Ah. I was hoping to get a nice score, but no. I had to die today.
Yeah, so.
But I'm everything when I'm DM, you know. Don't exist.
I was talking to someone about roleplay, and I said that, you know, the first roleplay thing we did, it was a dungeon crawl, and I got to, like, the last room of the dungeon.
Last room. There was just one more to go, and you're like, let's go back to town.
So you like, okay, he's not going to go to the dungeon. Let's bring the dungeon to him. Well, what I'm saying
No, that was several episodes, several sessions later.
Yeah,
you know, because... That was a completely different dungeon. I kept dangling it in front of your face, saying there's an easy way to solve this, but now you have to face the full force of everything. And if it were not for fucking Princess Punk backstabbing you, that would have been a lot worse for you.
But my whole point is that I wasn't going in the dungeon, so you brought it to me.
Yeah.
And the whole point is think on your feet.
Mm-hmm.
That's part of it. Yeah, she backstabbed... I don't know.
You are so pissed off, but you loved it. You loved getting pissed off over the right things. That was something you could respect. And it created cannibal pits.
Oh, I respected it, even though...
That was a great trap. The front lines are riding in. They failed their dex saves. They fell in, and now they're being consumed.
Oh, I respected it.
Well, that was the first wave of invaders dealt with.
It ruined my plan, but I respected it. And now her character is...
dating the other character.
Yeah.
After being ditched by the dragon, she decided to romance. And then going off and killing not just that dragon, but also its family, its relative, which almost killed you.
And now she's pregnant.
Yeah.
And trying to miscarry, although... Black Metal is hoping she doesn't, so that he could... That's his first army. That's his first baby in his army.
Which isn't even his baby. It's the dragon's baby. Which is the whole reason she's trying to miscarry. This is the baby of the ex-lover. It's not working.
See, that's the thing. I know you were a little bit annoyed by some of the things, but I did have a plan. Because Strixes are supposed to hate humans, but he's... different. He's going into human society. Now, why is he doing that? Is it because he genuinely likes humans? Or is he undercover? Well, he's trying to breed an army.
That works for me. I was fine with trying to plan that.
Using the humans as vessels.
There we go.
So, yes, we have... Oh, I love the one... You killed children in your game. I don't like this anymore. We killed non-existent children.
Yeah, boo-hoo.
Not even, like, in video game world.
Yeah, I mean, fucking shit. He wouldn't have wanted to be there with Boink, because he used his special sauce to cook children after he killed them. Yeah. Anyway,
so my point is about DMs is there are things you expected me to do. Like, I think you expected me to not fight the ogre, or whatever. Uh-huh. But then there are things that I did that you were like, okay, I have to think about this for a minute.
Oh, God, the death cloud. That took... I had to stop the campaign to think of the full ramifications, because too much had happened. It was just chaos everywhere, all across town. And I had to compute everything. So I was like, okay, while they're dealing with fire one on the other side of town, no one would be over to deal with the fire at the fucking apothecary, who was also the local poison smith. And he had the recurring poison. Oh, God. Death
cloud. Sometimes, though.
A third of the city died thanks to you.
Yes, because we killed the poisoner because I wanted, which I could have probably afforded.
And the funny part was, like, you know, a fire broke out in the middle of your combat, and you put out the fire. Then the moment you found all the vials of poison were ruined, you set the place back on fire.
It's ruined. But and then sometimes an idea, like you mentioned, as a throwaway, Valor's is listening to the voices in his head. That was supposed to be a throwaway. It was just, you know, it's the next morning and whatever. I latched onto that and we came up with sexually transmitted religion.
Yes, that was like a glorious, glorious invention. Sexually transmitted religion.
Which culminated in Valorous
becoming the chosen one.
The
entire brothel. God, the penalties to your roles after that.
I can't.
Anything physical.
You try to masturbate, and it hurts.
Yeah, it hurts too bad to continue. I want to continue. You took 6 hit points of damage. Not even subdual. This is flat out damage now. You're not getting the pussified version of it that's non-lethal. No, you're killing yourself by masturbating now. Do you wish to continue? No. You fucked an entire brothel. What do you think would happen?
But it was all for a good cause. And we got the shopkeeper's daughter to help us kill the shopkeeper.
Yeah.
That was romantic.
And then she consumed him.
That's... And of course, I mean, having someone else to play with, it's, you should feed your house more.
Yeah, that was great.
I had to think on my feet for that one because she was ruining my carefully concealed plan to, you know, be all nice to these people.
And backstab them in the long run to do it all subtly. She was fucking being up front like, you should feed your house more. What? My child's like...
Don't worry. She needs to be drunk.
Yes.
So then you actually had people...
Offering her booze out of nowhere because they believed you.
You actually had people, I don't think you're drunk enough, ma'am.
Yeah.
That's the thing about RPG. If you get the roles right and you have a weird enough imagination, anything's possible.
Yeah.
Like I said, someone believing that you need to be drunk in order to function.
Yeah.
Oh, ma'am, I don't think you're drunk enough today.
Here, have some whiskey. Here's a half gallon of whiskey. Have fun. It'll help you through the day, ma'am.
What was the one where you, was it you or one of your friends shoved a lock down someone's throat?
Oh, God. That was, like, the worst part of it. Because, like, my friend drew up a level 1 character. And he decided to get the level 1 equipment. And he... got a lock for no reason. It was a masterwork lock, very difficult to pick, you know. So, and multiple sessions in, like, we were getting close to, like, you know, we were starting to run out of regular levels and we're about to go into epic level. And he just got pissed off at this guy, grabbed a lock that he had since first level out of his pack, jammed it down his throat. And he says, if you want to breathe, you better pick it.
I'm guessing the guy didn't be able to pick it.
No, there was no hope for him at that point. Because you got to remember that, you know, he succeeded in the grapples and strength checks and all that. There was no hope for the guy at this point.
I liked using a goblet as a bludgeoning device.
It's always good to use your foes as bludgeoning devices. You're not the first to have done it. You won't be the last. It's just such fun beating your enemies with their friends.
Yeah. The stupidest was the goblin trying to use a broadsword.
That was you.
I know it was.
It was great.
It
was a human-sized broadsword, too, so it's like... Ah.
Yeah, for those of you who haven't seen it, it's on Jim's YouTube. It either missed or it was spectacular. There was no middle ground. It either missed horribly...
Or something was cleaved.
Yeah. My favorite was still the sleazy shop owner who wanted to mug us. And I took out the broadsword.
He was a street corner dealer. He tried mugging you, but you mugged him back better and left him dead and realized he had nothing on him.
Yes, in his last picture.
He is going to, you know, help you out.
And his
so
last
you helped him out.
Yeah.
I found out, you know, how pathetic it was.
Yeah, I sliced him so hard that his bowels erupted or whatever.
Yeah, and then, oh, he has, like, jack shit on him. Well, I get it. And you're like, wait a minute, this sounds like a cop-out. No, he was trying to mug you.
Well,
I had to tell you that out of character. It's like, he was trying to mug you because he knew you had loot. You'd already sold shit to him before, and now he wanted all of it.
Well, I guess he failed. Also, I love eating the girl while she was still alive. Because I like humiliation. So you went all this way. Not only has your fountain betrayed you, but your enemy is now consuming you. And you're aware of this.
Yes, we hope you enjoy the last remaining glimpse of life you have as you go into the afterlife with the horrors etched in your brain.
See, and people are listening to this and going, wow, that sounds really depraved. But, you know, we're generally normal people.
I guess.
We don't go, you know.
That's fucking awesome.
Yes. No.
You should listen to more metal.
RPGs do not lead to actual violence.
Exactly.
I just want to be Debbie. I don't want to be this. Remember the Jack chick? Lost in character. That was funny.
Alright. Now it's time to call this puppy.
I think so. This has been the Swine Brothers Show, episode 183. If you'd like to get in contact with us, you can email us at CosmicGodsDie@gmail.com and Facebook is, as always, Swine Brothers. Like, comment, subscribe, and share, people. We really want comments.
Interaction is good.
Interaction would be awesome. For the gym, I have been Elliot. Remember to buy the music if you like it. We'll see you next time, kids.
And then I shat upon myself.
That's good junk to beat up some midgets.